will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Now, Partisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne. I'm laughing because the song, actually, the intro to the show actually only goes about a minute, and then it started going into whatever was next. It was Obama actually calling for one of his, government reporting minions. So you could kind of hear right at the end there, Chuck Todd. So anyway, we are here live on this Wednesday, May 20th, 2015. We have a interesting show for you, kind of disturbing in some ways. I started looking at some different things related to GMOs, which is the main topic that we were going to cover tonight. A lot of it, not just being the actual things that they do to food and all of that stuff. That's some of the most disturbing things, obviously, and how it can affect people's bodies and all of those things. But also just how, ruthless some of these corporations are. And there's really only a few, of course, Monsanto being the biggest one. And I think the one that most people are familiar with, but there's a lot of other things along with that besides the actual food. I mean, there's the protection from the government. There's basically, even in thinking about this, and of course we'll get into more detail in all of these things. I mean, none of this could exist without the government, in my opinion. And everything that has really been created relating to GMOs is essentially could not, again, in my opinion, would not function without the government at all. So as I look for a document real quick, I'd also like to mention Ellen Ball will be joining us as she does at least every other Wednesday. So, and it's always great to have her on. But thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weekdays, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. You can listen on Spreaker and nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, as well as exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force, as all governments are based on power, control, and ruling over others and achieve this through violence and force. And I did, unfortunately, I guess it depends how you look at it, kind of took a nap after my paying job and then woke up probably like 20 minutes ago, and I'm still kind of trying to wake up here, which probably is better for me as the show goes on, but then is not so good for me in the beginning of the show. So I guess it depends on how you want to look at it. But I'd like to bring Ellen on. Ellen, thanks as always for joining us.
Yeah, thank you for having me on, Dave.
I know it's kind of been a while between I actually had a it wasn't a vacation, although it was in Orlando for work. And then last week, I know you weren't feeling well, and I really wasn't feeling well neither. But
yeah, it was a combination of things where I hadn't slept and I wasn't eating, and it just added up. I felt really sick. I even if I had been on, I wouldn't have done a quality job. And I don't want to do that to you or to anybody who's listening. So I just made the wise decision.
Well, it was probably better anyway, because I was debating, you know, whether I was going to do it anyway. And of course, if you, you know, are still planning on doing it, I just, you know, still would have done it. So it kind of just, it worked out. It ended up working out well. So, and of course, you know, doing three shows a week and working full time, and I think putting enough, you know, time in here. So.
Yeah, definitely. I don't think anyone blames you for skipping a night of a show that you create on your own.
Right. Well, that no one wants to listen to anyway. So what the fuck do they care? I'm kidding, but
I want to listen to it.
Well, thank you. So. We kind of had on the last show we talked about, we got a little into GMO slightly, which kind of brought us to the idea of you know, talking more about it and doing a show on it. And, you know, we talked more just about the food itself and, you know, it being bad for you and stuff like that. But there's really so many political aspects to it as well, where it's not just, you know, looking at food and, oh, well, I don't want to eat that because it's bad or it's not as good for you. And depending on what you look at or who you listen to, and I don't know if you had, you know, read any articles or watched anything, but, you know, some of the stuff, and I still tend to, you know, anything that's really extreme, you know, I'm still cautious as to whether, you know, to totally believe as far as they go. But there's a lot of stuff that regarding, you know, GMOs, not that they've, and this is the other side of it, though, not that they've actually done studies on, however, that really doesn't mean much neither, but on what they talk about as far as what it can do to your cells. And, you know, when you think about, there's like pesticides that I think there's something where it just explodes the cells of bees or something like that, you know, and it kind of common sense is just like, okay, well, if you have a some kind of pesticide, something you're putting on food, and you know bees are like exploding from it, you know that can't be good for people.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. When you start studying into such a touchy subject like GMOs, you have to be aware that there are two very extreme sides, I might add, and they both are going on little, you know, verifiable studies or facts. You know, this is still a very new technology, so people are really just guessing and you know, trying to make things sound worse or better than they
yeah.
are. So, you know, you have to go into it with a mindset that, you know, you can't completely trust everything you hear. Like, you have to be selective in what you choose from the studies and, you know, the articles and the videos that people make. Because some of them make GMOs out to be, you know, the devil. Like they're the total, like they'll be the destruction of humanity and you know, the world's entire ecosystem is going to collapse. And then there's some people who say that it's saving the world and that, you know, people have food all over the world now that they never would have had before, and we're solving vitamin deficiencies and saving people, you know, cost of pesticides, things like that. So, you know, you hear both sides and it's kind of confusing, but you kind of have to weed through what's true and what's not.
Yeah, and that's what I was kind of saying at the beginning, where you know some of the stuff I was listening to was that where totally extreme, like you know, oh, people are just gonna be walking down the street one day and just explode. But you know, usually with a lot of things like that, where you have two extreme sides, it's usually somewhere in the middle. However, you know, some of these things. When you look at them, it's just common sense a lot of time tells you maybe not that it's, you know, so horrible that, you know, you're gonna, you know, die a horrible death or something. But I think to me, more evidence than not points to it's not a good thing. It, you know, as opposed to, again,
So
you
we have
know,
two sides now.
that one. Well, I mean, looking at it from the, you know, just some of the just common sense type thing, and we can get into more detail, but just like, you know, like when you talk about something like just pesticides in general and the certain stuff that's being, you know, sprayed on it, or, and it goes way beyond that. Just
Yeah.
that I obviously lean more in the direction that it doesn't necessarily mean, again, that it's something that is so horrible, but it you know doesn't seem to be something that is a positive thing neither.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll pick a side if we're gonna choose teams right now. I definitely Well, at least for a few reasons, I would lean more towards, you know, GMOs not being a good thing. And, you know, hopefully we'll be able to go into more detail in that. But you're right. It mostly is about just common sense. And like, if you understand molecular biology, then to me it would seem kind of like a scary concept, you know, just messing around with genes and not really knowing what we're doing.
Yeah, I mean, you have that too, and kind of one of the things I started going into, because I've always related it to this, is cancer, and it doesn't, you know, I don't think there's any studies that really they can relate it to cancer or anything like that. I mean, you can look at statistics and the
Have been
increases
studies. There
in,
was,
I'm
sorry,
sorry.
there was one famous study I just want to mention that everyone points to that's on the non-GMO side, and that's the study where the rats were fed nothing but GM corn and grew tumors.
Yeah.
But there's like scientific flaws in that study. But yeah, that's just the main one that everyone uses. That's like the universal thing that people point to when they say GMOs are bad, and this is why.
Yeah, and you can see the pictures of the rats on the event page of the show. But yeah, you're right. That is the one I think, because you know, just like anything else, they're looking at it like, how can we convince people? And look, we can take these shocking pictures of rats with giant tumors, and you know, show, oh, look, it's because of this. And you don't, you know, with any study, there's all these different variables and all of these other things. So it's really, you know, hard to, I think, say that that's exactly what contributed to it. No matter how you look at it, it doesn't look good.
Yeah, that's true.
But
It's not
yeah.
like a shining moment.
But I mean, I kind of, one of the things that I guess I look at it, and it's, you know, I guess it's really one of the few ways, because again, there's not a lot of studies. But then you look at that too. I mean, why are there not a lot of studies? And maybe there's, financial reasons for that, because it seems to kind of start from the money. And that's what brings me to the whole thing with cancer as well, is that there's a lot of money in this. And that's where a lot of this seems to come from, at least, in what I saw.
I think you're right that it's related to money, but it's not so much that scientists lack funding to do these studies. It's that legally they are bound. They cannot do it because these plants are owned by companies that, forbid them from studying these plants. They're only studied in, private facilities owned by the company that owns the plant.
Right, right. So that's what I mean when I was saying money, not that they don't have money to do studies, but yeah, it's the money of those companies that and we can get into that too, that there's so many of these agreements like that. It's the insanity, and this is why I think, and when I'm saying money, I'm talking about the money that they're making, these, like Monsanto, and even if you look at the cancer industry, because the extent that they go to go after people and control stuff, and it's just, that's some of the stuff that, you can debate whether how bad it is for you or how valid the mouse study is, but when you have people being brought into court and being sued because they're violating patents, I mean, that those are documented cases.
And it's really the patent laws that are making it so difficult and mysterious for everyone. Like, really, they're working against themselves, I think, but it's the patent laws that are basically screwing up, any advancement that we could be making with genetically modified organisms.
Yeah, definitely. And that's where, I mean, with this, it's hard even where to, where to start, because there is just so many, I think, different parts to this that it's even to this point where I'm kind of going from, well, you have this part and then you have the they're suing people over it and it's about money and whatever. But I didn't look a lot into the history. I don't know if how much you know about the companies, but I did look at cancer and the war on, quote unquote, because the government, it's a war on everything, right? And
turn everything into a war.
Yeah, everything's a war that the government does, which I guess because of the love of violence. Even the Department of Defense used to be called the Department of War, which that's really what it is. So it would make more sense.
That's better as defense, though.
But yeah, but I just looked at, because one of the things that I was aware of, and I didn't get a chance to pull the statistics, but it's something like, 50%, or it might even be more, of the amount of money that is generated from cancer treatment is just ridiculous. And from what I looked at, it sounds like, and this is just my opinion, I guess, or my opinion based on that information, but it would seem like that if, and I think I've said this before on the show, that if cancer was cured tomorrow, that the medical industry would just fall apart, like literally, because the amount of money that is generated because of cancer treatment is just a huge amount of money. And, not to mention all the, donations and all that, but just all the you know, money paid for chemotherapy or this medication or that medication or whatever goes into it. And I'm not necessarily saying that, you know, again, there's not really a direct link there, but looking, I guess, as more of a theory.
Kind of like a conspiracy theory to me.
Kinda. I guess it kind of is in a sense, but you know, so I guess we can start with that, but just a theory. But yeah, I mean, I'm not saying that means that, okay, well, although maybe I am, because even if you get rid of the GMO aspect, I really do think with anything that the money is not in a cure, the money is in the management. You know, if you look at any disease, if you cure a disease, where's the money there? I guess unless the cure is so much money that, like, they can, I guess, make all the money that way. But I mean, once you cure something, that person, you're not going to get any more money from that person. But if it's something where they constantly have to take something, I mean, you even look at stuff like, you know, the SSRIs, which are all the, you know, antidepressant, anxiety, whatever, that you have to take every day for the rest of your life because they build up in your brain or whatever. And it's funny how that's what they push now. If you try to get something, because I even had this experience, if you try to get something and say, well, I'm just kind of stressed out right now, can you, you know, just give me a prescription for, like, you know, something I can just take when I'm stressed out for like a month or something? They won't want to give you that, but they're quick to give you, no, we want to give you this that you got to take every day forever. So kind of meaning that the money really, and it's sad to say, because you would hope, well, yeah, doctors are there to help people and cure people and make people's lives better, but you know, that's where the money is. And in cancer, again, if you look up the statistics of how much money is in cancer, it's ridiculous. And I don't see how the medical industry, again, could really survive if you took all that money away from cancer treatment. So,
go ahead. I was just going to say, you're absolutely right that prevention is much less costly than, you know, treatment of an illness is. And I used to study into the cancer industry when I was younger, and I found something called the Gerson therapy. And basically, it was an all-natural cure for cancer, where it was just you eat a vegan diet and get coffee enemas, and that's supposed to get rid of all your cancer. And it worked for a lot of people. Now, I understand there's more aggressive cancers that might not work for, but I feel like, you know, you are onto something there, where the medical industry is getting paid by pharmaceutical companies to push certain prescriptions. And, you know, that's why you find so many people on all sorts of drugs now. But I think it's kind of a leap, I mean, at this point anyway, to assume that, you know, the cancer industry, or the cancer drug industry, I should say, and, you know, GMO companies are in it together, where they're like, let's cure more cancer, or let's cause more cancer, and then we'll cure it with, you know, your prescription. You know, that's, like, I don't want to make that claim yet, but yeah, the medical industry definitely has an interest in, you know, keeping people sick but well enough to function.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, like, I don't know that I'm saying that they're, you know, really in it together, but that there may be some correlation between GMOs and cancer. Not that they say, hey, you know, make sure that you poison all this food so then more people will have cancer. I mean, that's a pretty big leap. Although, you know, to be honest, at this point, and, you know, I, I'm I'm not somebody who focuses a lot on what people would call conspiracy theories. I mean, there are some things to me that are just common sense that it's easy to speculate and say, well, yeah, this makes sense. But I don't put anything past, you know, government anymore. If you look at some of the things that are pretty much, you know, provable at this point, it's hard not to look at things and say, well, anything's possible. But that's not really.
Yeah, and can I just point out when you say government is involved, a lot of board members on companies like Monsanto or, you know, other companies that produce certain chemicals or.
I'm sorry, did we lose you there, Ellen? We may have lost Ellen.
Just now?
She's back, I think. Ellen, are you there?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I think we just lost you for a second. Sorry. Yeah, you were the last I heard, you were talking about something about, boards of the companies and in government.
Yeah, a lot of, you know, people who have held significant positions in, like, safety or development or, you know, just management of certain genetically modified companies or pharmaceutical companies have also held at one point like government positions where they switch back and forth, where they're part of the FDA or something like that. So, you know, it's not just a claim like they're part of the government or the government's controlling these companies, but, you know, these people actually do intermingle and they know that they can profit from doing so.
Yeah, it's all revolving doors. It literally is. It's just like you said, it people will go from government to these companies back to government. It's crazy, but it's exactly what happens. So, yeah, I mean, you have that as well. But I mean, I think with, you know, the I guess the cancer aspect is just, I think, another part of the money that comes in. And I think that may be a beneficiary of what a lot of is happening with all the GMOs and things like that, because cancer has been going up. And this is something too, where one statistic I heard that, and it was in general, because specific types of cancer, they have made advances, but something like since 1920, you know, there's not a lot of advances, I guess, that they were saying in general, from what I had heard. But, like, specific types. But, I'm sorry?
Since 1920, everything about our lifestyle has changed. You know, our diets, our daily habits, and the incidence of cancer has gone up quite a bit. But then again, you know, that's being counteracted by, you know, medicine. So I feel like cancer has gone up since then, but it probably seems closer to even with treatments that people can get.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's gone up by a lot. Like when you look at the same way when people are looking at autism and things like that, although that might just be a diagnosis, but with cancer,
well, we also overdiagnose now.
they didn't have
any way to do it back then.
But I think with cancer, like, you know, whether they get it before or after somebody dies, I mean, probably for the most part, and maybe they could miss some, but I would think that there's not that big of a discrepancy in diagnosis of something like cancer. Like, you know, like there's other stuff, you know, where, like we were saying, autism, obviously, there's just, I think that there's an increase, but I think there's also an increase of just diagnosing people where they weren't before. But I think something like cancer is not necessarily has anything to do with that there's literally a percentage increase. But you can also look at other things and say, well, what about all the wireless stuff now and cell phones and microwaves? And so, I mean, it's no matter how you look at it, I guess it's really hard to pinpoint what is the specific cause. And even all these scientific studies that they do, I look at almost every study as somewhat subjective to a certain extent, because everybody goes in with a certain paradigm. They're trying to prove a certain thing. And unless it's something that's just so clear cut, I think it's really hard to be able to really prove something. You know, just like you think about like lawyers and how, you know, they can present cases and people in a debate and how you can make one thing look like, you know, depending on what side you're on, you can make one thing look how you want. So I think a lot of these studies, plus the ones done by the companies that have a vested interest. So, you know, if you're talking about, you know, companies like Monsanto who claim that, oh, no, this is good for you. Or, I don't know if they literally say it's good for you, but oh, it's not bad for you and whatever. Obviously, they have a vested interest in it not being bad for you.
Right. And, you know, there's a lot of studies that have been done that weren't peer reviewed. These scientists that did the study just got so excited that they released it before it was peer reviewed. And then, you know, they would have to like throw out their work after that, or, you know, they would be fired or something like that. So, you know, there have been cases like that, but it is hard to isolate all of the scenarios, you know, to where you have one really good control group to prove whatever it is you're trying to prove. But I think, yeah, I like you said, a lot of studies are somewhat subjective because, you know, people choose what they believe before they do the study, or, you know, like Monsanto, their funds rely on it. They don't want to lose any amount of profit, so they're going to find ways to do that. And, you know, one of the things that I find kind of, you know, a little disturbing, it just makes me question them slightly, is when they term things as something that is generally considered safe, or, you know, it's something that they haven't proven is bad or good. It's just generally considered safe, where, you know, they don't really have an opinion on what it is. But, you know, there's reasons to not trust these companies. Like, obviously they want you to buy their product. That's why they, you know, they produced it, they have the patent on it, and they're selling it in stores, and, you know, they're putting it in places that you would never expect it to find. You know, so it's definitely hard for me to like wrap my mind around what, you know, how much truth is in a study that's done by a company that owns the patent.
Right. And obviously they, you know, it's in their best interest. So I think one thing that most people would agree on is that it's in their best interest, and it does benefit them to do all the things that they're doing regarding, you know, whatever they're, however they're modifying food or whatever they're doing, that it is in their best interest. It does make them money. So I don't, right there, there's a conflict of interest, no matter how you want to look at it. So just because people are making money off of something doesn't mean that they're doing something wrong. However, it seems to go even further than that in all of these things that they're doing. So
yeah, there's reasons to not trust companies like Monsanto, there's actually a specific scenario in a town called Anniston where Monsanto had a facility and they were leaking toxic PCBs into the environment, and all of these people were getting sick and dying. And they didn't inform the public. They just told the government, the local government, and nobody was ever informed. You know, and they quieted it down by settling in a lawsuit where they paid a ridiculous amount of money to keep these people quiet. But, you know, it's just something like that that shows you can't really trust large corporations to be vested in your health and your safety. It's more so, how much money can they get away with earning?
Yeah, and from what I understand, and I don't know all about the history of Monsanto, although I do have a friend whose father worked for Monsanto, and this is probably, and he's a lot older than me. He's in his early 50s, and so his father, probably worked for them, Jesus, in like the 60s or something, or in the 50s. So they've been around for a long time, but I know the one of the other companies is Dow Chemical, and it which is, and I assume Monsanto is the same type of company, that they're chemical companies. So when you talk about food and chemical companies, there's just something that really shouldn't go together there, food and chemicals.
Well, I mean, food is just a specific arrangement of chemicals. It just
Yeah, but
depends on what arrangements you
right.
put together.
But that's not the type of chemicals that I think they're talking about. You know
Are
what I
you
mean?
thinking
That's
of
more
Roundup?
ingredients. But they're like I think a chemical is like paint thinner or like
Yeah.
some type of chemicals like that.
There's
But
something that the company actually sells called Roundup. That's Monsanto's main, source of income, or at least it was for the longest time. It was their main pesticide, and it's non-biodegradable. Like, they once advertised it as biodegradable, but took it off the bottles because they were sued more than once for false advertising. So, these companies do produce chemicals that sort of feed into whatever it is that they're selling besides that. And like, in the case of Roundup, it's the Roundup Ready crops that they sell in conjunction with it. But yeah, I know what you mean by chemicals, like things that are dangerous or toxic to us.
yeah, and that's, I mean, those are the type of things that it sounds like, they're putting in there. And the same way that there are so many things that the government has been able to not necessarily totally suppress, but just hide or keep out of the mainstream. One that always comes to mind is jury nullification, where more and more people know about it now, but it's something that they somehow just almost made disappear just because they didn't want people to know about it. So you think about something like that, the ability of government to get rid of something or to maybe not get rid of it is the right word, but to kind of suppress things or hide things. You would think it would be hard, oh, well, because people always say that too. Like, well, they couldn't do that because all these people would know when they talk about it. And unfortunately, that doesn't ever seem to be the case.
Yeah, well,
That.
they know people have a short attention span. So if you can distract them with something else, then they'll forget about the original problem.
Well, even with the people that do, because I you hear that sometimes too, where people will come out and say, well, yeah, someone would say something about it, but people do say something about it, and they just say they're nuts. The people that actually do come out, oh, those people are just crazy. They demonize them and whatever. But this whole
That's because they
thing,
don't want to think
oh,
about
sorry, go
it.
ahead. Yeah,
No,
but
I was
it.
saying that's because they don't want to think about an issue that they're not familiar with.
But with Monsanto and these other companies, Monsanto especially, I believe it was what, 2013 now as well, they introduced a bill, and I think they even call it like the Monsanto Protection Bill. Like if you look up Monsanto Protection Bill, that's pretty much what comes up. So you have a company that essentially had a bill written to protect them. And from what I understand, and I might not understand the entirety of the bill, I didn't go through and read it, but from when it was passed, that essentially that they can create whatever, you know, crop or something, and people can start like getting sick and dying from it, and they can't even put in an injunction and until like something has to happen first or something like that. Like they can't stop them from continuing their work on something. And I think that was just part of it. And I think there was more to that as well.
Interesting is that back in 2008, Obama actually overturned legislation that was blocking companies from studying into like human animal chimera. But that's just a part of it. The other part is that there's as much funding allowed for in the government budget into studying genetically modified organisms as there is in agriculture. So it's a very large interest in the government's eyes anyway.
And yeah, it's funny how you have all of these studies, like ridiculous studies that you can find that the government puts money into as well. And this doesn't seem like something that they're at least, doing anything to disprove anything that, I don't know what there is to disprove except.
Well, they're not doing anything to help people learn the truth and, be truly safe. They're just, in it to help get more profits for these companies and, for themselves.
And that, and this, I think, with this, it's a perfect example of really how the government operates and how much it has nothing to do with protecting people or keeping them safe or any of that. It's all about money and power and control. And I think he had even said before he signed that bill, the one in 2013, I think, either 2012 or 2013, that, he wasn't going to sign it or whatever. And of course, so he signs it and didn't really hear a lot about it except in, independent media, but that was it. And it's, you have what it seems like. And I think it goes beyond just stuff like cancer, but it's like you have a whole generation of kids that are going to grow up on this stuff or have been. You even have things like hormones that are injected into animals. And you have studies where girls are entering into puberty at a much younger age, than they did, say, 30 years ago.
Yeah, and boys are like 6 inches taller on average now. And, a lot of that can be attributed to the growth hormones.
So then that's where it goes to. And some of this, I guess, is speculation. And I definitely, a little later on, want to talk about how I think this would work without government at all, which I don't think any of it would even be possible. But, I mean, what is the real motivation behind it? And that's where, possibly it's just, is it just the money? Is it that much money that they're willing to, well, I guess if they're not doing any studies on it, who knows what the top people know? I can't see that or believe that the top people at these companies have no idea or just think, oh yeah, well, it's probably okay. Yeah, maybe it might, some people might get a little sick, but whatever, it's not a big deal. Like, what do you think that these, executives and these people that are making these decisions at companies like Monsanto, what are they thinking about?
Well, I think they're mostly thinking about, how much profit is in it for them and, how much they can enjoy their time while they're still here and, pass it on to their children or whatever. And, there really is a lot of money in it. Think about how much you eat products that even contain a tiny amount of genetically modified organism, like Corn syrup is a big one because that's made from corn, and more than 90% of the corn grown in the US is genetically modified.
Yeah, that and that seems like the worst from what I saw with corn. That was what you had mentioned, earlier with the rats. That's it, from what I understand. I mean, that's really bad. Are you there? Did we lose Ellen again? It looks like Ellen is there.
Can you hear me?
Oh, okay, there we go. Yeah, no, I was saying that the as you mentioned the corn, that from what I understand, and that was that what they used that study on the rats as well, was the
It's
corn. But
corn and beets, and in other countries, it's things like rice and eggplant. Pretty much anywhere you go in the planet now, you'll find something that's genetically modified. But in for the most part, it's in, a lot of the food we eat because a lot of our staples now are, corn-based, or they contain sugars or something that's genetically modified. So I feel like there's a lot more money in it than people realize, especially when you take into account the fact that, to produce these crops, it's really that intensive.
but is it, I mean, how, and I guess people can justify anything, however they want, that they can somehow justify it in their mind that, well, it's not that bad or whatever. But,
Well,
oh,
I
go
don't
ahead.
want to pretend to know what's going on in these people's minds,
Well,
like
yeah,
even
but.
if knew that what they were doing was wrong, it's hard to know exactly what justifies it to them, to let them continue profiting on it, knowing that people are getting hurt.
Yeah, no, and that obviously happens with, a lot of different industries where they know that they're hurting people, or they, but this is obviously, I think, a lot different. I mean, but I would think that they, whether, obviously studies haven't been published, but that they know the damage that that's a lot of this stuff is probably doing. I mean, it just, again, it's hard
Well,
to, or sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say that they know to a certain extent, but this technology has only been used since the 70s, basically. So it's hard to tell the full effect, but they know that if there's a say there's a field of genetically modified soy planted next to a river, which is pretty common, and then all of the pollen comes off in the spring and it contaminates all the other plants around it. Not only does that enter into the genetics of the plants that it lands on, but also other insects and animals that feed on those plants are going to experience the effects of whatever the genetically modified organism is. And usually it's something like BT. So if there's a bunch of caterpillars that are feeding on milkweed that's right next to a GM field, then they're going to be eating the BT pollen, and they will die off. And that might not seem like such a big deal, but think about the other animals that rely on those insects, like bats and small creatures. Like those are going to start dying off too because they're not going to have as much of a food source. So it's really a chain effect, and to fully understand it, this technology would have had to have been studied and used for, at least twice as long as it has been now.
Yeah, I mean, I think the ramifications of it are, far exceed what most people would think. It, almost like, if you take a disease that's airborne, and every time you, shake somebody's hand, they get the disease. It just spreads through everything, through all these different ecosystems and things like that, And, you know, that's one of the things. And this, that was the extreme side. But, it, you know, it did talk about what it would do to, you know, the DNA of anything that it affected and how it would change it. And it's hard to know. I think that part of it, and maybe there's probably stuff out there on this too, but I didn't, it wasn't something I got a chance to see, but exactly what they're doing. Because I think some of the stuff they try to look at like, oh, well, we made a seedless watermelon and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not going to hurt any, like to look at like the positive stuff that doesn't really do much damage or something, I guess. And I don't know personally that a seedless watermelon does anything bad. But I think the things that they're doing, you know, far exceed things like a seedless watermelon, you know,
yeah,
where
that's true. It does extend far beyond that. But to even know, you know, how dangerous a seedless watermelon is to us, you know, we would have to, you know, study it through generations. And that's really where the damage takes place is, you know, over long periods of time, because it's not a sudden change where you eat the seedless watermelon and all of a sudden your, you know, your guts explode. It's more
right.
So you have
it's over time, yeah.
That are produced and you know, the genes in your gut are you know, actually changed, and you know, there's, you know, little illnesses and you know, like random sequences of DNA that are just causing havoc in your cellular systems. So, you know, it's hard to tell, but I don't think that we're going to be able to see or study into it too much until, you know, there's a generation of people that are raised solely on these genetically modified organisms, and I don't even know if that's going to happen. And that's what they're trying to, you know, recreate in lab studies. But then again, you know, it's not as if people only eat genetically modified soy and corn. There's a whole lot of other things that are probably healthy and are, you know, acting against whatever effect they have. So, you know, it's hard to tell. And something that is a very specific science, especially since we don't even fully understand how our own genetics works. You know, we've just recently decoded our own DNA. And, you know, being able to understand how all of these chromosomes code for different proteins, that's, you know, that's not something we fully understand either.
But I would say just, again, and I go back to cancer, I guess, for a few reasons, just because from what I understand, you know, cancer is a mutation of a cell. And it, you know, spreads and starts mutating other cells, which seems consistent, you know, again, with this is all speculation. So it would be consistent with speculation, but of a lot of the things, you know, when they're talking about some of the effects of some of the, you know, genetically modified things. And kind of like what you were saying too, though, if you have so many of them and they're, you know, I don't know the specifics of what's done to what, but maybe, well, this one's okay, but this one is not. And like you're saying, it's not something that, you know, you're going to know like the next day. I mean, you're not talking about things where it's a level of toxicity where, yeah, if you eat this, you're dead. It's over, you know, years and years and seeing what it does. But based on, you know, the cancer rates going up and things like that. And again, I'm not saying a conspiracy between them, but what I am saying is that it, you know, not only just looking at the literal statistics, but it just seems like the cancer is just everywhere, man. It's just everybody. You know, I'm sure knows somebody who has cancer or had cancer or maybe died. It's just like, I think it's the number two or no, I think it's tied. It's right at the top, I think, between cancer and heart attacks of the number one causes of death. And I don't know.
That's hard to judge, though, because I've, you know, There are studies that say that it's because people put so much of this in their diet, you know, like it's meat or it's dairy or it's, you know, something else, like smoking or being in the environment where there's all of these toxic chemicals floating around in the smog. So, you know, that could be anything. I don't know if that's, you know, something that's directly relatable to GMOs, but it could be. Like, I'm not counting that out.
Yeah, I mean, it is, and to your point, I mean, it's hard, and what we were saying earlier as well, I mean, you have so many of these things, it's hard to say, well, it's got to be from this, because you'd have to have some kind of controlled environment, and how do you even do that? So you're going to have, okay, well, we're going to take you guys for the rest of your life. We're going to have you in this controlled environment where you're not exposed to any of this other stuff like cell phones and TVs and microwaves and whatever, and lock you in a room or something. I mean, yeah, you can't really, but on one side, that's what benefits these companies, because there's not enough to go after them neither, or to hold them accountable, because they could say, well, you know, prove that that's what it's from, and you really can't. But from what I understand as well, that the majority of your immune system, or a lot of it, is actually in your gut as well. So I know that can't be helpful neither. And of course, you know, I'm not an expert in any of that or anything. But
That's where digestion happens mostly. That's where you absorb the things that you eat, is in your digestive system.
right.
So, you know, it makes sense that that's where a lot of, you know, your immune responses kick in. Especially, a lot of digestive processes are actually controlled by the bacteria that are in your intestines, and it's pretty impressive. Like, all in all, there's probably 2 to 3 pounds of bacteria in your intestine. And that's fun to think about.
Yeah, that's gonna I'm gonna
You
have some
do a lot.
nightmares tonight, being attacked by bacteria.
Yeah, but they, you know, they absorb some of the minerals and nutrients that you eat, and in exchange, you know, their whatever their excretions are usually things that we can absorb, and you know, that's how it helps us to digest things. So, whatever you eat basically also affects the bacteria in your stomach, and you probably know this all too well if you've ever had food poisoning, because that's just when the bacteria in your stomach go totally haywire, and you have too much. You know, if you have E. coli poisoning, you already have E. coli in your system. It's just when you have too much in there that it makes you really sick. So, you know, your diet does really affect your health overall. And if it's, you know, just small changes in your health over time, then that's going to add up in the end. And, you know, like, I don't want to say that that's causing cancer for a lot of people, but, you know, maybe it is.
Possible.
We don't really know that for sure.
And the other thing, and we'll take a break, and then we can talk about this though. But if, you know, companies like this are, you know, on the up and up, and all of this stuff is so good for you, or at least not harmful you, for you, you know, why do you have the government going out and going out of their way to essentially almost be the watchdogs or attack dogs for these companies? Because you really almost have that with a lot of this stuff, whether it's, you know, just from any type of lawsuits or going out and going after people because their seeds blow into, you know, their garden. So when we come back, I want to talk about that. I also want to talk about later, a little later in the show, how I think this would work without government, and how it would obviously, I think, be a lot better. You're always going to have those people that say, oh, well, yeah, without government, you know, Monsanto would be running anything. Well, that's kind of what's going on right now. So we're going to take a quick break. And we will be right back after this. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com and on Spreaker. and we'll be right back after this. As soon as I find the clip I'm trying to play, which will probably be the wrong one, but oh well. Well, maybe that wasn't the clip I was going to play. I'll just play another clip. My very professional show. I've been off for a week. What do you want? We'll be right back.
I'm asking everybody to go home and to clear the streets. Tomorrow, everybody's going to meet at the church so that we can figure out, so that we don't lose focus on what it is that we're supposed to be doing.
Has this surprised you today?
It's disappointing. We're just hours out of the funeral. The family is just hours after putting their son to rest to come just a few blocks away from where we had the services. Disappointing.
No one should control nature. No one should control life. No one should have that right to put patents.
What do you say to bring them up? Bring calm.
It is one, this is not what the family asked for. Today of all days, the family was very clear that this was a day of sacred closure in the funeral. So for us to come out of the burial and walk into this is absolutely inexcusable. I'm asking every young person to go back home. Tomorrow night we'll have a community meeting for us to really recalibrate because peace is the call and the order of the day.
Do you think this is just frustration and anger, or do you think it's much more than that?
It's frustration, anger, and it's disrespect to the family. The family was very clear. We've been saying it all along. Today, there was absolutely no protest, no demonstration.
Labeled the Monsanto Protection Act, or H.R. 933. So much so that it's led Senator Barbara Mikulski to publicly apologize for letting the provision slip through. However, this is really only a small part of a much bigger pattern of corruption and collusion between Monsanto and the U.S. government. Senator Roy Blunt, a Republican from Missouri, who crafted the wording for H.R. 933, has been accused by Senator John Tester of having collaborated directly with Monsanto in the creation of the provision. This shouldn't be surprising considering that Monsanto is one of Blunt's top campaign contributors. Blunt also accepts contributions from the Crawford Group, a registered lobbyist for Monsanto. Now, the controversy in this bill is tied to Section 735, which is, of course, written in such a jumble of incomprehensible legalese that it's highly difficult to interpret. It's designed to make the eyes glaze over without registering that anything of significance has been stated. This is facilitated using a common legislative technique of referring to sections of a separate law, so that you have to go read the unintelligible fine print in that second document in order to understand what's actually being said. That second law, in this case, is the Plant Protection Act. In the description of this video, you'll find a link to both documents. Now, what Section 735 of H.R. 933 states is that if a plant is determined to be a biological pest and is therefore brought under regulation and restrictions which prevent it from being planted or transported within the U.S., the Secretary of Agriculture shall immediately grant a temporary, permanent, or deregulation to any farmer, farm operator, or producer that requests it, regardless of what any other laws or courts may order. Now, the word genetically modified organism isn't mentioned here, and that's part of the skillful way that this was designed to slip through. Only someone who knows that by default genetically modified organisms are considered biological pests until they've been approved by the Department of Agriculture, and that they are reclassified as pests if shown unsafe, would understand the implications here. To distill this down to one sentence, if a farmer wants to grow a genetically modified plant that's been outlawed because it's been found to be harmful to the environment or human health, all they need to do is contact the Secretary of Agriculture, and they will be immediately issued a permit to cultivate these plants. Essentially, it makes it impossible to stop a genetically modified plant from being used in the United States, regardless of any laws or rulings that are made to outlaw them. Now, of course, one might be inclined to let Obama off the hook for signing this law. After all, it is written in legalese, and one could presume that he just made an innocent error. But this would require overlooking the extensive evidence of the Obama administration's incestuous relationship with Monsanto, among which include his appointment of Michael R. Taylor, former Vice President of Public Policy for Monsanto, as his FDA Deputy Commissioner for Foods and Veterinary Medicine, his appointment of Roger Veachey, former Director of the Monsanto Danforth Center, into a position at the USDA as the Director of the National Institute of Food and Agriculture, and his choice of Islam Siddiqui, former Monsanto lobbyist, as his agriculture trade representative. Now, anyone who thinks that the revolving door between the government and Monsanto is something new should look into Monsanto's connections and dealings with both of the Bush administrations and the Clinton administration. This has been going on for a long time. The purpose of this video is not to motivate you to write a letter to these corrupt senators or to inspire you to vote the bums out. None of that will have any meaningful effect. The system can't be fixed at this point. Corruption runs so deep that it has become literally inseparable from the political machinery. We don't have corporations influencing government. The corporations have become the government. Only when you come to terms with this and realize that the solution to this problem is not going to be found in elections or petitions will you be willing to consider a course of action that really will make a difference. For more down that line of thought, please watch our video entitled U.S. Government Preparing for Collapse, Not in a Nice Way. Our only chance lies in reaching a critical mass of awakening. We need to reach that critical mass quickly. It's not for me or for anyone else to dictate to you what your role in this awakening should be. It should be obvious that we all need to make an effort. If each and every one of us makes use of the skill and the knowledge that we have to alter the course that we're on, I sincerely believe that it would be enough. In that sense, don't wait for a solution. It may be you that has the solution. If you feel it's important for other people to hear this message, please like and favorite this video and share it through as many avenues.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. Again, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We are here tonight talking all about GMOs or genetically modified organisms. That could actually mean a lot more than, I guess, just food. I guess in the future, or probably right now, we don't even know about it, that people or animals or whatever are being genetically modified, or you're going to have half dog people or some of the shit that you've seen probably in movies years ago. But we are here with Ellen Ball, who joins us at least every other Wednesday, hopefully more often in the future. But I know that sounded like a creepy kind of video, but some of the stuff in there was based on, you know, there was some opinion, but there was, you know, some fact in there as well regarding signing the bill and the close relationship with Monsanto and the government. So that's where I guess, you know, when we look at this, it's okay, well, if this was just any ordinary company, and I know that the government does help a lot of companies to basically take over industries and give them all these benefits and things like that, but there's not another company that I'm aware of, and that doesn't mean that it doesn't exist just because I'm not aware of it, but with the type of relationship that they seem to have, that the government has with Monsanto. I mean, well, I'm sure there's a lot of defense contractors and stuff like that, but I mean, outside of those.
Yeah, it's true, because, you know, Monsanto makes a lot of money, and Dow Chemical, the one that you mentioned earlier, you know, companies like that, they, you know, they basically, their product is what we eat, what we need. You know, it's an inelastic demand. We're always going to need more of it, and there's always going to be money made off of it. So, you know, of course, people are very interested in, you know, getting their hands in these businesses and, you know, making ties with them, because there's so much money, and it's guaranteed to keep coming. You know, even if there is, you know, 10 more anti-GMO movements, you know, they're still going to be making money, because people don't, either they don't put in the research to realize how much food they're buying from this company, or they don't care. And, you know, usually it's that people don't care. But yeah, that's why they're going to keep, you know, buying things, you know, that are funded or created by these companies, because, you know, they're not realizing the full extent of their actions. So, you know, the there's a lot of money to be had, and, you know, who doesn't love money? Who doesn't want to be more rich, you know? And I also wanted to mention, you said something earlier about, you know, half human, half dog, chimera, basically. And I just want to refer to a story that I heard about while I was researching for this. You know, I've always known about, you know, like hybrid animals. You know, people have been artificially selecting animals for hundreds and thousands of years. Like, that's why we have all the different dog breeds we have now, because we've been, you know, changing wolves over the years to fit whatever, you know, we want them to be, whether they're good hunters or lap dogs or, you know, protection dogs. You know, we have all these different things that we've created, and we've changed the genes in these animals. But it's always been through a natural process of, you know, we'll just have these specific two breed together because right. they have certain traits. But now we can actually go in and tinker with individual genes. And there's something produced that sounds like it's out of a sci-fi movie, but this actually happened, where there was a company that put funding into creating basically a spider goat, where there's a goat breed that had genes from spider silk, well, the whatever chromosome it was that controlled spider silk creation, or the proteins. It was put into goats so that when they produced milk, they had that protein in their milk. So, you know, they actually could milk goats for spider silk. And, you know, we've been doing cool stuff like that for years, you know, since this technology came out. That's where insulin comes from now. If you go to a hospital, or, you know, if you just are diabetic and order your insulin and, you know, inject it yourself, pretty much any insulin you get now is from genetically modified organisms, because it used to be you just had to, like, squeeze out the juices from a pig or a cow liver, and now you can just modify certain bacteria so that they can produce human insulin. So that's pretty cool. I mean, they can be used for medical advancement, and I know it sounds scary to think that, you know, we're, like, mixing up different traits from different animals, but there's, you know, chimeras like this everywhere, where, you know, There's fish you can buy at the store that that glow neon, and that's, you know, from different genes from, like, some phosphorescent jellyfish or something like that. You know, so it's kind of common now. I think people are getting more comfortable with it, but it's still a frightening idea. Like, there's all sorts of horror movies created about it that scare people. You know, I think there's one called Splice. You know, the alien movies are kind of scary, but the precursor to the alien movie was called Prometheus. I don't know if you ever saw that.
Yeah.
that was pretty fascinating to me, and that's when my interest in genetic engineering kind of peaked, because it reminded me of a scenario where, you know, we're changing genes in animals now, but how could we change our own genes to improve our species in the future? And that's kind of what the movie got into. But I think it's a fascinating concept nonetheless, and I hope people aren't scared away by it. I mean, there are a lot of dangers that come along with it, I think. You know, like we were talking about cancer before, that's always a danger, and new allergies being produced and things like that. But I think there's a lot of potential in the technology, even though it is something that we can't fully predict. Well, right now, we just have to, you know, keep practicing and learn how to control it better.
I mean, I think you have a couple of things there, because you have one, you know, the difference between somebody, I guess, quote unquote, volunteering and being given stuff that they don't know what it is, in the case of, you know, GMOs. And then definitely technology. I mean, there's so many things that can be done that are positive when you think of things like, you know, people that are paralyzed and being able to, you know, regenerate, you know, cells or nerves or whatever, or all of these different types of things that can be used to improve the quality of people's lives. And really the scary part isn't always necessarily, I think, what the technology can do. It's who's getting a hold of that technology. And usually it's governments. And those are usually the scariest fucking, you know, entities, because the first thing, and you'll see this in, you know, every movie, what's the first thing that the government wants to use technology for? Well, it's for the military, for war, for things like that. And I'm sure they're doing, you know, experiments right now where they're trying to create super soldiers and, you know, all of these things like that. And if you look at movies like, you know, my movies, the Bourne movies, where, you know, they were feeding, not feeding, but they were giving them these special drugs and kind of, you know, wiped out their memories and trying to create these kind of super soldiers and stuff like that. So that's where I think the scary part really comes in, is the people that are usually the ones who have the means, the money, all of those things are governments, and they don't have the best intentions.
Yeah, and if you think about it, it's even more scary because the government is the body that, you know, controls IP law. You know, so if a company has intellectual property rights on this living organism, you know, they, like, take for example golden rice. It's supposedly a savior of people in Asia because they were having vitamin, or the Middle East too, because they're having vitamin A deficiencies that caused them blindness and other illnesses. And this golden rice was genetically modified to contain vitamin A. So it's saving people's lives, and it's improving their livelihood, their quality of living. But how, you know, it really makes you question their motives when you realize that according to IP law, there's only specific entities that can reproduce this crop. You know, you have to purchase some sort of agreement with the company to grow it. You know, so they're making money on it, but they're not letting anybody else get a hold of it. You know, it's not as if you can spread this technology or this information, this life form, around freely. You know, like information on the internet. It's very controlled. And it's almost as if they don't want it in the hands of everyone. They just want it in the hands of people who can pay them. You know, so that makes you wonder, you know, what are their motives really to improve people's lives, or is it just for profiting?
Well, and that's when you get into one of the things where the government essentially protects those companies, where and it's goes to a ridiculous extreme. So there was that bill, which I think, again, there's more to it as well. It's something like it pretty much protects them from being sued as well. So I think the two main parts, it protects them somehow from being sued, and it also stops, you know, judges from putting an injunction, you know, in something they developed that, you know, people start to get sick or something, they can't just automatically stop them from making it. But you also have all of these cases of people or farmers that are being sued because a fucking seed blew into their farm. It's not even like they took the seeds. And first of all, you know, I don't believe in intellectual property anyway. And how you can fucking create a seed and say, you know, think about that for a second, how ridiculous that is. So even if you create the seed, right, and then, you know, most plants, depending on what they are, the seeds somehow, you know, like say flowers, they scatter off, whatever, and they plant new ones. And so you're going to patent those seeds and say, well, we have the right to these seeds. So if you grow anything with our seeds, and I don't even think they have to sell them, you know, they're allowing these companies to fucking sue farmers. What it seems like to me is that, like they're doing with all these other companies, they being the government, that they're creating monopolies to be able to control everything. So it's like you can't even become a farmer, because no matter what, some fucking seed is going to get in there, or, you know, somehow you're going to be infringing on their ridiculous patents, and you're going to be, you know, put out of business.
Yeah, well, the fascinating thing is that companies, they don't even have to create seeds. They just have to find seeds that have not been patented yet and change them slightly and define the change that they made, and then they can patent it. Or, you know, even if nobody owns the seed, they can just, you know, patent it. Like, oh, I own violets now. That's, those are mine. But, you know, there's, it's kind of silly because there's really no way to enforce patents on living organisms. It's too impossible of a task because, like you said, seeds blow around, and not even that, just pollen, because, you know, pollen is something that plants use to create seeds. So if there's a GM field next to an organic field and the pollen blows over in the wind or bees carry it over or something like that, then your plants are contaminated. They contain that DNA, and now you're infringing on, you know, the Monsanto's IP. So you know, you have to burn your crops after that. And literally, they will do this. They will send a team of lawyers to people's farms and test the field, say, oh, we found some of our genes in your plants. These belong to us. You're not authorized to have them, so burn all of your crops.
Yeah, they had...
It's devastating.
They had people, you know, that were being interviewed that were saying... It was almost like a SWAT team in the middle of the night coming and you know, instead of seizing like marijuana or something, they're seizing like their crops and or burning them or whatever. And it's crazy. You would think it would be the other way around. It's like, hey, your fucking seeds contaminated mine. But no. And the government is sanctioning this and, you know, passing all these laws and protecting these companies and I mean, I guess I don't know what their rationale is as far as publicly, if they even have said anything as to why. I guess they could say, well, it's for food because we have to make sure that we have food. I don't know.
Well, I think it's mostly that it's easy for them to sway public opinion towards IP because they use the argument, you know, well, these companies invested millions of dollars into the development of this technology, and they deserve to get their profits back. It's the same argument that they use for, you know, art pieces. You know, like somebody patented this specific set of tunes. So, you know, that's their only source of profit. You're not going to take that away from them, are you? But that's, you know, leading people under the false assumption that you know, companies or individuals can't make money without patent laws. And, you know, that's entirely possible because if you're the first person to create something, you know, you're going to make the most money off of it, especially in the long run. So it's just the old argument, you know, that IP is valid, that I think makes it publicly justifiable. You know, even these ridiculous, like Percy Schmeiser is a, I guess he's the best known farmer who's had this happen to him where his canola field was, basically infected with genetically modified plants. You know, maybe it was a truck that drove by and spilled out a bunch of seeds and now his fields are contaminated and he had to burn his crops. But that was, I think that happened in Canada, and that was
I think that was the one I heard about as well. Some video I was watching or listening to that, because I remember it was in Canada, and I think that was the same one.
Yeah, but really, it's just ridiculous, you know, that they'll go to such lengths to protect their patents, and you know, people think it's okay to own these ideas, these living organisms, but they spread. They spread exponentially, so there's no way to control it. You know, there's no way to act, at least logically to me, it seems there's no way to enforce these patent laws, but they're laws, so, you know, they don't have to make sense. You just have to follow them.
And, I mean, I don't know what the end result is. Of this is because you're going to have less farmers. You're going to have just like, you know, like a department store like Walmart where, you know, 99.9% is all one company. And they'll be, it's different though in the sense that controlling the food is a lot more important than, you know, controlling shit at a department store. Although I guess you can buy food at Walmart now too. But when you can control the food, I mean, that's kind of scary if you get to one or two companies that basically control the majority of the food production.
Yeah, that's people's lifeline. That's how they survive. It's something they need all the time is food. You know, people are never going to not need food to survive. So, you know, like I said earlier, this is going to be a constant source of profit. You know, and there's really a lot of money to be had from this. Like, for something like the Flavor Saver tomato that was created in the 80s, it was resistant to wilt, but individuals who were found growing this in their private gardens could be fined, like, 2,500 euros, which I'm not sure how much that translated to at the time, but, you know, if you were a company and you were found growing it, you could be fined 500,000 euros. So, you know, they can still make money from this in really any way they can find, and it's legally justifiable. So there's not really anybody who can fight against them because, you know, they've got the funds. They can draw out the legal battles to the point where you can't afford it anymore. So, you know, most people give up the fight because they have to after a certain point.
And that's where, you know, and last night I talked about a little about this as well, and we were talking more about, you know, currency collapse and Jade Helm and things like that. But just the whole point that you have so many things that are going on, obviously, because if there wasn't, then I probably wouldn't have a lot to talk about. And I have plenty of shit to talk about because there's so much fucked up things going on. But, I mean, at what point, and I keep getting to this because I think, I was saying this last night, I think the majority of people, I honestly do, well, the majority of somewhat intelligent, or maybe that's giving them too much credit, somewhat just not stupid people, I don't know, that the majority of them, I think, realize that the people that are elected are not the people that are running the country or the government. Now, I'm not saying that they think that some secret cabal is, but whether it's, you know, the millionaires or the companies like Monsanto or whatever, or a combination, you know, of lobbyists and stuff like that. I think the majority of people realize that, you know, it's from all this other influence, regardless of what it is. But yet the majority, well, really not the majority, I guess, vote and probably believe in all that shit. But knowing that you can't change the system really through the system, and of course, and what I believe, I don't believe in the system anyway, so why would I try to change a fucking system that I don't believe in using their, you know, it's like already losing the game before you're starting. you have to play a game that you want to change by their rules. But what the fuck is there left to do, really? And, you know, it's like every day, and maybe, you know, I'm over, you know, maybe overreacting, over exaggerating. I don't think I am, but, you know, and of course I'm on a show anyway, so that's what I'm supposed to do. but I honestly feel that way. But I mean, at what point, I mean, where do we get to a point that it's like, okay, well, this isn't working. I mean, yes, we can go and protest. Yes, you know, we could, I don't know, try to boycott stuff, or definitely getting, I think, the message out there is important, and educating as many people as possible. But it's like, it's like a dam where you have all these holes that keep, you know, you plug up one hole and there's another and another and another. There is just so much. So for even if you're able to change some small things, and I think you can more on a local level, and it depends on where you are. I know New Hampshire is a better place to be than some other places, maybe to change things on a state or local level. But at what point is it like, okay, we can't do shit because for every little thing we do, they do, you know, 100,000 things that, you know, now we got to deal with those.
Yeah, well, you're right. In a lot of cases, the ladder has been kicked away where, you know, there's certain regulations and laws that have been built up so much. You know, companies have so much money now. You know, things are in an unnatural balance where we, it's hard for, you know, regular, everyday, normal people to respond positively to these situations and be able to make an actual change. But, you know, the most beneficial way to impact, you know, some imposing power like this is to make it totally impotent. So something, as an example, this is what I do, or what I try to do anyway. Since I don't
for the record, that is not one of my favorite words, but okay.
No, but it does have a specific meaning.
Not that. Well, that just made me sound even worse. Never mind. Go ahead. I, of course, anyway. Never have had that problem, just for the record, for everybody. Okay, thank you. All right, sorry.
We're all wondering. But anyway, what I try to do is I just try to be a wise consumer. So I don't want to support certain companies. I don't want certain things in my food. Like, I don't want pesticides. I don't want, you know, like, resistant super bacteria. I don't want genetically modified organisms. You know, so in most cases anyway, unless I'm in a rush, I will take time to read the labels and, you know, look at the packaging and actually trying to figure out what I'm buying that I'm going to be putting into my body. And, you know, a lot of the time, when you bring up something like, oh, I shop at the co-op, people laugh and they say, oh, that must be so much money. Like, it's $5 for a loaf of bread. But I feel like, anyway, paying more money up front is going to prevent me a lot of hassle in the future because right, I'll feel better, I'll be healthier, I won't develop as many diseases or
you
have
need a, you know, an operation that
my body.
Cost you $1 million or something.
Right. So just, you know, don't give your money to these companies that you don't like and they won't have money to fight you. So like, you know, if everybody stopped buying Monsanto products, then it wouldn't exist. And like, it doesn't have to be a boycott. It can just be, you know, choosing what you find healthy and what you don't. So maybe Monsanto does make one or two really good crops, like, you know, a petunia that changes color. You know, people love the petunias, so they keep buying them. You know, that's fine if they still exist, you know, like 100 years from now.
And that Porky Pig's girlfriend. Petunia Pig. It was Porky Pig's girlfriend, I think.
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about.
Porky Pig, you know, Porky Pig from whatever, Bugs Bunny and all them, and there was the Porky Pig who.
Oh, I see.
He had a girlfriend, Petunia Pig. Anyway, yeah. Sorry. Go ahead.
Like, what if in the future there's pigs that change colors, like the petunias, you know, and people ended up eating them for some crazy reason and getting really sick. You know, if there's still alternatives around, then they could just decide to buy the alternative and, you know, there would be no demand for this color changing pig anymore. So, you know, demand would just die out. But sometimes there's not really many other options. Like, in some cases, the market's totally saturated with, you know, something that's owned by a company that's almost a monopoly or an oligopoly or something like that. You know, so maybe the only option for, you know, like cornflake cereal that you see in the aisle is, you know, it's all genetically modified. There's no organic non-GMO cornflakes. So
no,
you
there
have
is.
To they, buy the GMO.
There version. Is literally everything because I do buy all organic food that I buy at the store. My problem is a lot of times, you know, especially if I'm at work and I didn't bring anything, you know, and then I'll have to go buy something somewhere and then, you know, that food is probably really shitty. But you can literally buy anything you can think of organic. Whole Foods has tons of stuff and you have other places as well. And then, you know, I'm sure Every state or local area has their own little markets as well. So yeah, I mean, you can literally buy everything organic. It is a lot more expensive, but to me, it's worth it. But, you know, something like that is something that you can do. I don't know how much that's going to change things for anything else. If a bunch of people did it, it would help. It's definitely going to help you personally or anybody that does that. But I'm even saying, and maybe I'm just getting more negative or something, but I'm saying, okay, well, that's great. I got organic food, so that's going to help me. At least I'm going to be healthier. And I literally, when I started eating organic food, I could totally tell the difference. And I've talked about this before. And
it tastes so much better.
It does. It's so much fresher. You can totally tell the difference. I even felt healthier. And then I started drinking Pepsi again, and that fucked me all up. But I mean, that's one thing. But what I'm even saying is, and the more that I think about it, you know, it's just like, you know, okay, well, I have that covered, say, but that's not going to stop the police from coming by and beating the fuck out of me or robbing me or the government from imprisoning me for things I'm saying on the internet. You know what I mean? So what I'm trying to say is kind of take this a step, you know, further in that, because it was something, you know, I was thinking about last night as well, is that, you know, we have so many fucking things, literally. It's just like, you know, there's probably, you know, and as aware as we are, I mean, there's probably a bunch of things that we don't know about that are going on too. You know, that's public information, but I mean, they're good at hiding it kind of in plain view where, yeah, if you go on all the government websites every day and have nothing, you know, no job, I guess, and don't sleep, maybe still even then. So it sometimes feels like it gets to the point where, you know, maybe you can change some small things, but it's almost like getting to that point where you're being attacked from every fucking possible area. And how do you even fight back? And when I say fight back, I'm not necessarily meaning physically fighting back, but just how do you combat that anymore?
Well, there's a lot of different ways. That's why there's so much activism that exists. Even here in New Hampshire, you know, people go out cop blocking. They do jury nullification outreach. The Robin Hooding was one of those things where they were trying to, you know, visibly impact the income of the city government, and they succeeded in doing so, but also made everyone hate them. So,
well, not everybody, you know, right?
What's that?
Not everybody hated them.
Well, not everybody, but largely in the public eye, they were viewed as jerks and idiots.
Which is insane, like, because they were helping people. I mean, oops, something just fell. They were helping people, and it's like, it's people's thinking is so crazy, and I really do put a lot of that on the government and just how it's so calculated. I really think, you know, and some people might think, well, the government's, you know, stupid, and they are in some areas, but I really think a lot of this stuff is very calculated. Just like, and the example that I always bring up is, you know, a political campaign, and they hire, you know, all these experts that will even test like words or phrases or whatever and see how they test. And I think they do that with everything. I'm thinking that they have these people that propagandize every little possible thing to influence opinion, to influence this, to influence that. And I honestly think they do that. And maybe I'm overthinking it, but it seems very calculated, a lot of the things that the government does.
Yeah. And also, you have to consider, this has been going on for years and years, you know, since, I guess the biggest example would be like World War II. You know, there's a lot of propaganda, like pro-war stuff, you know, Rosie the Riveter, you know, and on to Vietnam,
They even had the Warner Brothers cartoons, like with I think like Marvin the Martian or something, and they were running after like Japanese people or something during World War II. Yeah. They had some
some propaganda that said pay your taxes.
Yeah, but yeah, they had even cartoon propaganda that they were trying to put out there.
Yeah, but you know, they've also been doing research into like subliminal messaging and and you know how to really connect people and hit them where it really matters. So you know they know how to do this. They're master planners. They know how to set up systems and to regulate and legislate. You know they're very practiced at it, and there's more and more people getting involved all the time. So you know they've got plenty of help. They've got plenty of funding. You know, because the state and the federal government, they benefit from so many different taxes, tickets, you know, all sorts of forms of income. So, you know, they certainly do have the funding to keep going, and they're going to continue getting it because people, you know, really believe what they're being told. And it's you can't really blame them because it's being sold through so many different channels. You know, like on the radio, on television, cable shows, you know, anywhere you look, magazines, there's all sorts of...
Of course, government schooling and...
Right. Government schooling is, you know, probably one of the biggest. You know, so it's just something that is completely surrounding people where it's hard to see a different viewpoint when you've been told one or two different things your entire life. And, you know, all you know is the system that you've been born into, you know, so it's hard to see outside of that narrow lens. So, you know, I can't really blame people for being complacent, but at the same time, I want to, you know, like,
yeah.
I want to be angry because I know, but they don't. But then again, like, I didn't know at one point, and it's totally possible that in a different reality, I could just never find out. So, you know, maybe all it does take is just being public with your decisions. Like, yeah, I don't buy this brand because I know that it makes me feel like crap afterwards because there's all of these preservatives and GMOs and you know, another crazy thing I wanted to point out, like, I know this came up earlier a little bit, but you know, there's all sorts of new allergies being developed out of these GM crops and all sorts of bacterial resistance. So, you know, companies are having to formulate different ways of killing these bacteria off, more powerful pesticides or herbicides or more powerful prescriptions that they can give people. So, you know, there is a lot of money in that. And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they were interested in swaying public opinion in their favor for that.
Yeah, it's... Would you consider yourself, and I know you've told me before that, not as much now, but, you know, when you were younger, you're shy, and I can totally relate as well. But do you say if you're at the store or, you know, whatever, in line somewhere, or do you ever bring up any of these things to people, or are you just more kind of, you know, mind your own business? Or I would say mind your own business is not the right phrase I'm looking for, but is that something that, do you try to, you know, talk about stuff like that or try to bring it up to people if the opportunity presents itself, or are you just more like kind of standoffish? Because sometimes you don't want to just throw it in somebody's face. Like, hey, did you know that, like, these are bad for you or something or whatever?
Yeah. Well, I know that when I was 15 and I first became a vegan, and I was highly aware and hypercritical of all the food that I was eating. And, you know, it was something that came up quite often at the lunch table in high school, where I would start telling people, like, oh, you shouldn't eat that. That's gross. It's disgusting. And here's all the reasons why it's disgusting. And, you know, people really didn't like that. They were like, you know, and I don't blame them. People don't like getting criticized for their personal decisions. They feel like they're under attack and they get defensive. But I thought I was just trying to help them out, but in their eyes, they saw it as me attacking them and their decisions. So after a while, I realized this is my personal decision. I shouldn't be pushing it onto other people. Let them eat whatever they want, make whatever decisions they want to. You know, this isn't something that I need to confront people about. But there have been times where I'll be, in the grocery store buying something. I can remember one specific instance. I was buying a clump of ginger, and I got into a conversation with the cashier about how great ginger is for, just for your body in general. And, that was really great. And I was hoping that there was people listening because, it was like good advice and, great knowledge. So I hope that people will hear when I talk about this stuff, but I'm not going to push it on them if they don't want to listen. And there's definitely been, people who, when they first start to get to know me, they'll ask me like, "Oh, why did you become a vegetarian?" And then I'll go into that. And it's not just that I'm a vegetarian, I don't eat meat. It's more to like, I'm more mindful of things like that. Like, obviously I try not to eat genetically modified organisms. So that's something that's usually included in the conversation. So, I tell people if they ask now. I used to just accost people with it, but that didn't last very long. I never got good results from that. So now I talk about it if the situation calls for it, during a public thing like this where people are listening because they want to, I'm not afraid to say that I think certain things are disgusting or, I wouldn't buy them. But that's generally how I approach it, is just, it's not something I'm going to challenge people on immediately unless they bring it up.
What about the, because this is something I think that people of different, I guess, political backgrounds support. It's not, there are certain issues that just mostly libertarians support or something. But this is something that you could find people from all different, types of political backgrounds that, have kind of that same view regarding, GMOs and things like that. So how, I guess, or what are your thoughts, if any, on how to, I guess, take something like that? And it kind of, even with something like cop blocking is kind of the same thing too, where you have people that are totally just all over the map, that still see the problem with cops. But from looking at something like GMOs and then trying to show how, it is or can be seen as more of a libertarian type of idea there.
I don't know if it's, I don't know if I would make that claim because, being conscious of what you're purchasing and being anti-GMO, anti-pesticide, anti-hormone, that's not something that is dependent on your political view. That's something right. That's dependent on, just being logical and, being aware of what you're eating and caring about yourself and your loved ones. So, I guess you could say it's more libertarian because libertarians generally look into issues like that more, where, they try to be more aware of their surroundings and, knowing what's going on and, being just knowledgeable about how they're living their life and, really aware and conscious of their lifestyle. So I guess in that aspect, you could say that it's, related to libertarianism, but I think there's, there's all sorts of people who care about genetically modified organisms and getting them, to a safer place or taking them out of the food supply, Republicans, Democrats, liberals.
Right. Yeah. And that's what I was saying, that you have all types of people that actually, have that view, but it kind of, I guess,
they all have different solutions for the problem. Like, the solutions they offer are different. Some say it's more regulation. Some say it's different regulations, some say it's less. So, you know, it's all the same problem. It's just how you go about solving it.
Yeah.
That kind of hints at what your political leaning is.
And that's what I want to take a quick break, but that's what I want to talk about next is how I think that, and this is where I kind of compare it to more of a libertarian idea, is that the government, I feel, has essentially created all of this, in a sense, and by, you know, obviously letting this company get away with whatever, building it up where, you know, nobody can compete with them and things like that. So we'll take a quick break. When we come back, we will talk all about the, I guess, government influence over this, or the lack of government influence that I think would change a lot of this. And we'll be back right after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and check us out on nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
Well, Otto von Bismarck knew something about the nature of government, and he said, there's two things you don't want to see being made, laws and sausages. Well, as patriots, we want to know what goes into our laws, and we want to know what goes into our food. Now, we've had over and over again examples of large corporations using the government to punish their competition, to go after small businesses. Think about what the milk industry is doing to raw milk producers. And we've seen them use the government to protect them and to even to lie. Look at the food labels and how they are blatantly lying on the food labels and not telling people about the presence of genetically modified food and what you're buying. But we've never seen anything more blatant and more dangerous than the Monsanto Protection Act. Anthony Gucciardi writes, are you surprised? Monsanto openly wrote their own Monsanto Protection Act. He said, it should come as no surprise to many of you to find out that Monsanto actually authored the wording of its own Monsanto Protection Act, hidden in the recently passed and signed continuing resolution spending bill. He says, Monsanto is now immune from federal courts regarding any suspension or action on their crops that have been deemed to be dangerous to the people or in the environment. And here's what that means. He says, theoretically, 1 million studies could find that Monsanto's latest creation was causing a massive cancer wave. And under this law, Monsanto could continue to peddle the crop to the public. Now, in spite of the fact that an activist organization called Food Democracy Now! At the last minute was able to get 250,000 signatures on a petition to Obama to try to stop this, Obama signed it anyway. And in this article and another article from Mike Adams, we look at exactly how this happened. In this article, he focuses on Senator Blunt, who is from Missouri. He's a Republican from Missouri, and he's the one who actually wrote the bill most blatantly. But we also have, this is a bipartisan criminal action. Not only did it involve Obama, but it also involved Barbara McCluskey, a Democrat senator. As Mike Adams points out, and Obama betrays America yet again by signing the Monsanto Protection Act into law, he says that in this hidden backroom deal, Senator McCluskey turned her back on the consumer, environmental, and farmer protection in favor of corporate welfare for biotech companies such as Monsanto. That's a quote in the article from Andrew Kimbrell, executive director of the Center for Food Safety. Now, this new law, as he says, automatically forces the USDA, U.S. Department of Agriculture, to automatically approve all GMO planting permits sought by Monsanto and other biotech firms, effectively granting Monsanto dominion over the U.S. government. This is, by its very definition, fascism. Well, the very fact that they could get this put through shows that they really effectively already have dominion. They're just coming out in the open and making it a public law that they have dominion over the U.S. He also talks about Senator Blunt's involvement. Senator Blunt, the Republican from Missouri, he said he actually worked with Monsanto on a provision that, in effect, allows them to keep selling seeds, which can then go on to be planted even if it is found to be harmful to consumers. And he says that is stunning. Now, the gist of this article from Mike Adams is that Obama is betraying, that Obama has deceived. He points out that when Obama ran for office in 2008, he promised to end secret prisons, to decriminalize marijuana, to balance the budget, to honor the Second Amendment, even, and to make health care affordable. Everything he has done has been against all of that. And he points out that Alex was severely criticized in 2009 when he said these are fraudulent promises, and it's pretty obvious that they're fraudulent promises. And the name of the documentary was The Obama Deception. And now we see 4 years later just how spot on Alex's documentary was.
Visit InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. When you're on the site, you can also tune in 24 hours a day.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. We've been talking all about GMOs, and if you've never heard of GMOs before, that stands for genetically modified organisms. So again, I guess that could be a lot of different things, but in the context we're talking about is food and companies like Monsanto, which I would assume most people by now, especially in the last couple of years, are familiar with or at least know the name. And again, I know Monsanto has been around at least 60 years, if not more. But what I wanted to talk a little about now, and of course we are joined by the great Ellen Ball. I don't know if I should call her infamous. Well, because I think infamous, and just to give everybody a backstory, when Ellen was on Seditious Sirens, they called her the infamous Ellen Ball. But infamous is like a negative connotation. It means like you're famous for bad reasons or something. Like bank robbers are infamous. Like they're famous for doing something bad. So,
well, I'm infamous for jumping from podcast to podcast and not having my own. So
that's good,
I guess
though.
That's what she meant by that.
Oh. Okay, well, but that's not a bad thing. That's actually a good thing because you're sharing your talent with so many different people.
Oh, so, I'm glad you think so.
There you go. So that's a positive thing. But so before we went to break, I brought up just what I think is a lot of the causes of this being I don't even know if I would say a lot. I'd probably say all of them for the most part. But I guess I wouldn't put 100% on government, maybe 99.9%. But if you look at all of these things, and this is where how, you know, and I was asking you earlier about, you know, how people of different political persuasions support or not support GMOs, but don't support GMOs. But the libertarian kind of side to that, to me, is that government being the ones who have essentially, I think, created this. Because one, I mean, and you have this with basically almost every industry now, is you have the government, whether it's through regulations, barriers to entry, various tax breaks. Not that I think any taxes should be paid by anybody, but if you have one company who has to pay a bunch of taxes and another company doesn't, obviously it gives an unfair advantage to the company that has to pay the taxes. But looking at that from the standpoint of one, they're building that company up. So I think in a ideal world, or even just a normal world that wasn't backed by government and wasn't backed by, you know, these all these banks and investment banks and the Federal Reserve, that competition would work itself out just naturally. So I don't think you'd have any companies like Monsanto or Walmart or anything, because I think what would happen is they wouldn't be getting all these benefits. They wouldn't be getting, whether it's, you know, again, the tax breaks or the regulations to regulate everybody out. And I think it would just naturally, you'd have that competition. So if a company like Monsanto was doing what they were doing in a economy that wasn't controlled by government, they'd go away because nobody would be buying from them anymore.
Right. And that's the point I was trying to make earlier when I said be a wise consumer and, you know, study into what you're buying, because the money you give to these companies is literally what keeps them running. So, you know, your dollars as a consumer decides basically the future of what consumption is going to be. You know, like if you're spending, you know, hundreds of dollars at Walmart each week, it's no surprise when, you know, Walmart's around and growing, because there's many people who do that because Walmart has everything, because Walmart has the power to do that, where it can, you know, basically force negotiations, you know, where they say to a company like, you can sell your product for this much, but we're going to have to take some of the profits for giving it like this shelf space that's more prominent. So, you know, that's the kind of power that is rare for companies to come across. And, you know, usually when they do, it's because they've been helped out along the way through tax breaks and, you know, other various regulatory things that the government controls, where they are helping to create this monopoly. And, you know, it's like you said, it's not something that would arise naturally, because people, you know, they like a wide variety of things, and it's kind of hard to specialize in a wide variety of things. You know, most people, most companies specialize in one or two main things, and they do really well at it. Whereas now there's all of these companies that are, you know, getting a vast amount of cheaply produced products from like China, you know, and they're importing all this stuff, and that's somehow cheaper because they're avoiding all of these other costs that companies that produce in the U.S. are having to pay. So, you know, it is something that you can basically say, you know, if the government wasn't involved as far as, you know, just putting so much economic demand or demand on companies' finances, you know, this sort of thing wouldn't arise naturally.
Yeah, and I think once it gets to that point, once you get to the level of like a Walmart or a Monsanto or whatever other, you know, big companies that are essentially monopolies or biopolies, if that's a word, you know, there's like one or two, that it kind of gets to a point where you don't have any other options. And that's where it makes it harder, like where you're saying, to essentially vote with your dollars or so when you have a structure how it would normally be, where none of these companies are that big, it's a lot easier to do that, because you don't need as many people to put somebody out of business. Whereas when you have a company like Walmart, I mean, you need literally tens of millions of people to stop shopping there to probably put them out of business, as opposed to, you know, much smaller companies. There's no reason why really companies should be that big. And I'm not saying that from the standpoint of, hey, if you're able to do that without the help of the government, without, you know, all these other benefits, and you can accomplish that, then that's fine, because I believe in free markets. But one of the reasons, and I think the main reason that these companies become that big, is because of the government in tandem with the banks and the Federal Reserve System, because it sets up a system where there's just unlimited amounts of money that these big corporations can get. They're not going to give it to the little, you know, small business, but Walmart probably has access to, you know, billions of dollars if they want.
Yeah, I'm sure they do. And one thing to keep in mind though is that all of these massive corporations did at one point start out as small businesses, and they grew their way up in size. And that is for a reason. It's because they offered good services or good products, and people started buying from them. But at a certain point, there's interest being paid to them because, try becoming a business owner and not filing your taxes. You're going to be hunted down by the IRS. So it just goes to show that if you make a lot of money, and you're giving a lot of profit to the government, they're obviously going to take a vested interest in some point, and you're going to be given these benefits that other small businesses don't have, or
Right.
tax write-offs, ridiculous things.
But
So there is, that huge influencing factor.
I bet even the small ones, when they were small, that they probably engaged in business practices that other companies didn't because they were, whether they were illegal or just shady or whatever. And Walmart, from what I understand, is relatively new, right? I mean, it's what, is it more than 50 years old? I don't, I know
Yeah,
they have
I think
one
it
store, but
started out in the 20s or 30s.
okay,
I'm
then it
not
is pretty
sure on
old.
the exact date, but it's been around for a long time.
So, because most of these companies, and with tech companies aside, because that's a whole nother animal there with, technology and things like that being just new, like a company like Google or something. But it seems like all of these other companies, for the most part, have been around for a while. But I mean, obviously, I don't know this for a fact, but if I had to guess, I would think that they were involved in a lot of shady practices to get to where they are. And, of course, once they got there. But the other thing would be too, is that, the older companies, they didn't have the same regulations that they have now. So what a lot of these companies will do is, okay, once they become big enough where these regulations aren't going to affect them anymore, like minimum wage is a perfect example. So if you take a company like Walmart, yeah, they'd rather not pay more for their employees, but they can afford it. But at the
Yeah.
same time,
Can I just throw in? I'm
yeah,
sorry.
go
I was
ahead.
totally wrong on the date. It's 1962. I think I was thinking
Walmart.
of McDonald's.
Okay, then that, because that's what I thought. I thought it was somewhere like 50 years old or something like that. And this, okay, but I mean, it's still somewhat, old, but it's not as old as, I think Monsanto. But still, I would think that they probably were involved in some of those shady practices. But at the same time, same thing, that more and more regulations, as every year there's, who knows how many regulations. But like in the example I was saying with, say, minimum wage, that a company like Walmart can afford it and they're going to be fine. But you take some other, if you can even find a department store, a locally owned one, I don't even think they exist anymore. But say you can find one, they're not going to be able to afford it. So it's almost like regulating them out of business. But somehow people have been brainwashed or conditioned to think the opposite. To think that, oh, all these regulations will stop these big corporations, and really it's helping them.
Yeah, I just wanted to use something as an example. You said you're not really sure if there's any locally owned department stores anymore. Well, I actually used to work at one when I lived in Winchester when I first moved to New Hampshire. It was independently owned, and I knew the owner. He came into the store every day. We used to joke around, and people would say like he's probably got a million tucked away somewhere, but he wasn't profiting an awful lot from it. It was just that the people around this certain area didn't really have any city within half an hour where they could go to buy a lot of the things that they needed to buy. And this is a fairly undeveloped area. If you consider like all the large cities that are out there, you know, like this is a very small town. So this was people's main source of food and other basic supplies. And he made a fair amount of money. He lived a very good lifestyle. He wasn't a multimillionaire by any means. But they generally start you out at minimum wage and then give you raises throughout time. Whereas, some of the largest companies in the world, like McDonald's, they usually pay more than, the vast majority of their employees close to minimum wage. And, you know, they may pay managers more than that, but it's really based on their performance. And, you know, it's way below what they can afford. A lot of small companies that pay minimum wage or a little bit more generally are understaffed, and, you know, they just make the employees that they have work harder, but it's better than having, more people on the payroll. So, that does act against businesses in a lot of scenarios. Like sometimes people do work that isn't worth minimum wage, and that's kind of a drain on them. But that does affect businesses in a large part because, they need people out there stocking the shelves. And if they're not working hard enough to, earn that much money in an hour, which I think would take a pretty lazy person, but if they're not working hard enough to make, whatever it is, $7.50 an hour, it's not worth it for companies. And, sometimes they have to close down because they're paying more than they can afford. And, that's really kind of counterintuitive because that makes, fewer people jobs. And, where's the value from money coming from then? Because money is really just based on how much we produce. And, if there's not companies out there producing, then where's the value for our money coming from?
Yeah. And even with your example, and I'm sure there probably are some of those type businesses in other areas as well. But as you said, it was more of a kind of rural type area, right, where it wasn't close to a city. But usually, I don't think, maybe again, you'll find some, but I think for the most part, definitely department stores, that the only place you're probably going to find independent department stores is in those type of areas, unfortunately. And it's sad in a way. And what happens too, I think, is that, kind of what you were saying, well, yeah, he did well, but he wasn't a multimillionaire, that people automatically think if you own a store, you're some multimillionaire, and that, well, oh, he's just a greedy person who doesn't want to pay the employees enough, And there's a huge difference between people that own their own, small businesses and these big corporations. And really, and I can't really speak to other cities all that much. I mean, I've been in Las Vegas over 14 years now, but the businesses I see the most of that are independent, and even some of those aren't, is like restaurants. Like you do see, people with their own independent restaurants. Besides that, off the top of my head, and I'm sure there's other independent stuff, I can't really think of anything.
You'll find small boutiques that sell like clothes. Antique shops generally run on, a bunch of vendors getting together and selling all of their goods in the same building. Those are a few things that I can think of off the top of my head. Mechanics. There's a lot of, independently owned mechanic shops, point. Things like that.
There was definitely a lot in Boston that there were a lot of independent mechanics out there. Luckily, since I've been here, I've been buying new cars. Not that, because I had like a lot of money to buy a new car, just because I'd rather save the money, buy a new car instead of having to spend all the money to fix it. Ends up being the same. Anyway, so yeah, I mean, again, it seems like if you were to totally take the government out of it, so there are a whole bunch of things that we've talked about related to government. First of all, you have the patents and the ridiculousness of, so not only are those patents obviously taking money away from farmers, they're putting them out of business. They're consolidating everything and building up that monopoly that way as well. Because obviously, you know, if they put farmers out of business, who's going to take over? Who's going to take over that market share that's left there? So that's a result, really. That's totally a result of government, because what is a intellectual property and patents? That's just it's something created by government. You know, it's just like a corporation is an entity created by government. It's not a real thing. I mean, I guess you could say a patent is a real thing in that it's something that exists. But the fact that you somehow, you know, an intellectual property is really bad. I don't know how much you've read about intellectual property laws, but I mean, the things that you can fucking patent, or it wouldn't be, I guess, patent with intellectual property, but whatever, copyright, when it comes to intellectual property, it's just even like ideas. It is insane.
Yeah, it definitely is. I don't see how you can, you know, own a bit of information, you know, like verbally written in any way, you know. So that is something that it's totally unnatural, and it wouldn't exist without, you know, this governing force behind it, you know, trying to make money and, you know, pushing people into compliance. So, you know, like you said, it's real, as in it's a real part of our reality where we have to deal with that. But, you know, if we were living like any other species, you know, like, imagine if, you know, some dog hunts down a rabbit and then, you know, the rabbits come after him and say, like, you know, you violated, you know, that was our property. You know, you weren't allowed to do that. And then, you know, like the dogs turn into slaves for the rabbits or something like that. But that's a totally insane scenario. Like, that would never happen, you know. And to think that we're just, you know, we're still animals on a basic level. We have to eat. We have to live according to our values and, you know, keep ourselves alive and follow our survival instinct. But these sort of laws go against that. They go against, you know, basically everything that is conducive to being productive and living. You know, so these patent laws that are trying to control life itself, I totally find insane.
And it would be interesting to look at some of the history. And I know there was a change because I recently got to go to Walt Disney World. Well, one part of it, I guess, the Animal Kingdom. But when I was in Orlando, my one day off, I guess. but there was some Walt Disney. And I don't know if it was after he was dead and it was his family or not, but there was an extension of the patent laws that had to do with a Walt Disney case. Because it used to be something like, you know, 75 years, but then it was like life plus 75 years. Because they have stuff, you know, that goes into public domain after a certain amount of time. So, like, you know, you could sing some old stupid song that no one wants to hear anyway from, like, 200 years ago, and you're fine. You know, you're not violating any copyright laws there because it's in public domain. But really, I mean, I think some of it came from, you know, these big celebrities, but at the same time, it's like everything else. And maybe with me, you could call me more of a, I wouldn't say conspiracy theorist, but more paranoid when it comes to this, that I really do think that there is a huge level of motivation of what the government does based on control. That I do think money is a huge part of it. But I think it's also about obedience and control and continuity of government is a huge part in a lot of the things that government does. Now, of course, money can help you, help to bring you power. And you look at, you know, these multi-billionaires. I mean, you get to a point where what the fuck are you going to do with the money? Where really it's just, it can buy you control. It can buy you power, you know?
And that's something that, like, we have to understand when talking about this too, is that government is just made up of a bunch of people who like having money. So it's not like, you know, any one person in the government knows everything that's going on. And when we make these sweeping statements about government, we're condemning everyone for everything.
Right.
You know, because there are specific people who are more responsible in certain areas than others. You know, but they all have that main incentive where they're just trying to make more money and get more funding. So, you know, like, of course that's what this is about, because that's, you know, that's something that's universal to people. We all like money.
But it, like with, well, but then there's, and well, before I get to that, the reason I was bringing it up in relation to patents is because I think intellectual property and patents goes beyond money, that it also goes to control as well, because it's,
well, that's just an aspect of it, I feel like, because if you can control people in a certain way, you can extort money out of them. You know, that's how it goes most of the time. Like when you're pulled over for speeding, you're basically told, like, pay this fine or go to jail. You know, you have to pay taxes every year when you file. You know, there's all sorts of things, like even taxes on things that you buy every day that go to the government. So, you know, it's not something that you totally agree to, but you give your money anyway. And it's because, you know, you don't have any other option, or you're not looking for another option. So it is a form of control and manipulation, and that really just helps them. You know, if you're more compliant into, you know, giving them money, then they'll find easier ways of getting money out of you.
Yeah. And actually, speaking of that, I wanted to just bring this up briefly, because I thought it was something that I've talked about in the past, but it's continuing to move forward. And that is, in Oregon now, they're actually starting a test of the mileage taxes. So about, it was maybe over a year ago, and they were quote unquote testing in Nevada and some other states as well. But now when I say test in Oregon, like, they're actually going to do it with like a small group or something. But what they're doing, just like kind of what you're saying, another way to collect more money, is to put something in your car that will track the mileage. It will have a GPS as well, although they're claiming right now that you can opt out of the GPS, just like all these other things throughout history, that, oh, you can opt out of this part, and that only lasts, you know, a couple of years, and then you can't. But they're finally actually implementing it to a certain percentage of the population. And I don't know if when I had brought this up previously, or people that heard about it previously, I thought, oh, that will never happen, that's just whatever. But no, it is continuing to move forward. And it's, you know, one of the things, of course, is no matter what, it's never going to be enough. The government is going to do whatever they can to collect as much money as possible. They're saying, well, this is for roads and bridges, although the fucking gas tax is supposed to be for that. But now they're saying, well, because of all the hybrids. So you have the government pushing hybrids and shit and electric cars and all this stuff. Hey, we don't want all the gas emissions. So, but now they're like, hey, but now we don't have enough, so now we have to tax you for your mileage. So I just wanted to bring that up briefly as well, because I had noticed another article about that as well. But I had brought it up, I think, last year, and I had said on air, if they ever try to do that here, because it said they were testing in Nevada, I won't do it. I'll fucking take the thing and, you know, smash it off a wall or something. I probably shouldn't actually say that part on the air, but I won't put it in my car. It's not going to happen. But that's kind of what I was talking about earlier, too, you know, about all these things and, you know, like a dam with all the holes in it. I mean, when are people finally going to say, you know, and there are people that are doing it, not a lot, but stuff like that to say, you know what, fuck you. I'm not putting this in my car. And you know what? If you try to stop me, I'm going to defend myself in the process. And then, you know, I'm not even talking about, I guess, the violence or anything like that. But even from a self-defense part where it's, when is it finally like, that's it. We've had enough. We're not going to let you fucking, you know, push us around anymore.
Well, I think there's a certain portion of the population that's already come to that point. And, you know, they are generally kind of dismissed in the public eye. But I don't know when that's going to come. You know, whenever the next revolution happens. But, you know, I'm not really looking forward to it unless it's a peaceful revolution. And honestly, I think that's, or at least I hope that's where it's going to come from, is, you know, from all sorts of open source ideas.
Yeah.
And, you know, people just slowly changing their mentality. I don't want it to come down to, like, the government's coming to take away our guns, so let's defend it.
Yeah, know? I mean, it's unfortunate if it has to come to that. And I definitely, I agree with you. If you want something long term, it has to be peaceful. Now, I don't think that necessarily means that there's not some type of conflicts in between that. You know what I mean? Whether there's a riot or stuff, you know what I mean? I think that's kind of inevitable, but there's definitely a difference between people talking about an armed revolution and, you know, okay, there's some conflicts or incidences here and there. Because ultimately, if there's an armed revolution, then you're going to have, you know, who's the next person to take over and what's the fucking difference? Because really what you want is for people to believe in freedom and want them to be free, not out of fear, just because that's what they want. And I think that if you had something like an armed revolution, it's going to be the same shit all over again. So, yeah, I don't believe in that neither. I do, however, think that at some point, if it goes far enough, that there may be some conflicts, some violent conflicts, I guess, if that makes sense. And I hope there's not. And the last thing I'd want to see is people, you know, get hurt. But it's like the more you think about it and see how far things are going, at what point do you just say, again, not to go after anybody, not to initiate anything, but just to say, okay, I can't just stand here and let you, you know, just beat me. You know what I mean?
Right. I mean, after a certain point, people start to get, you know, defensive and irritated and angry. You know, it's like if you push them long enough, you're eventually going to, you know, frustrate them beyond a point where, you know, they feel like they can take it anymore. So, you know, I don't know when that's going to happen. I feel like people find a lot of really healthy outlets for that. And that's, you know, where they do, you know, activism or outreach or create some sort of, you know, information database or something like that. You know, there's all sorts of really cool stuff that arises from, you know, when people feel like they've been taken advantage of for too long. You know, like one of the most fascinating things that I've learned about in the past few years is Bitcoin, which is, you know, a cryptocurrency. It's like an alternative form of money. And people actually use this. Like, there's stores that you can go to and actually spend your Bitcoin, and it's not regulated by the government. It's regulated publicly. So, you know, that's really cool. And I hope to see more things like that arising, where it's something that everybody partakes in, and you know, everybody's knowledgeable about it. You know, and that's what I hope for. I don't want to see people get to the point where they get so frustrated and there's a violent revolution. But you know, I think it's justifiable that once, you know, a violent crime or an extortion, a theft has happened to you, then you have a right to respond to that. You know, because that is a violation of your rights.
Yeah, and that's really, I guess, my point there. And I kind of think, even with everything we're talking about with the GMO stuff and how it relates to the government, I mean, you could take all these other different things that are going on that's pretty much similar. The government dominating, the government picking, you know, winners and losers and controlling everything. But I again, would never support the initiation of force against anybody in the government. Well, I guess anybody in general. Well, I guess it depends what they did. But no, but I mean, you know, I guess if somebody like, you know, whatever, beat up your wife or something, or I was going to say raped your wife or something crazy like that, or kidnapped your kids or whatever. But with, you know, what I mean is, when it comes to things like that and it comes to the government, I wouldn't support any initiation of force or going after anybody. But yeah, when it comes to the thing that I think about, and probably even saying this on air could possibly get me in trouble, but whatever, is again just the self-defense part of it, and even trying to avoid it. Like, for example, I always bring up the Bundy Ranch and what happened there, where I think what happened there, I think, was a positive thing, because nobody got hurt, but people stood their ground. So they stood up to defend themselves, but luckily the BLM said, okay, you know, this isn't worth it, we're not going to do this, and that was the end of it. Unfortunately, I don't think police have that same attitude. I think if you try to defend yourself against a cop, and I don't even mean advance against them, if you said, hey, I didn't do anything wrong, you know, if they're an example like, you know, you're pulled over, get out of your car, and they have no reason to ask you, and you say, well, I'm not going to get out of my car, you know, they probably go to try to rip you out of your car, and if you tried to push them away or something, they'd probably just shoot you, you know.
Right. And like, in the moment, they have that power where they can force you to do something. And, you know, there's ways you can combat that. Like, you can have somebody in the car videotaping, you can videotape, you know, that can protect you in the moment. But, you know, that's where the force is ultimately committed. You know, when you're arrested and put into the cop car, possibly beaten or abused, you know, and hopefully you're defended in a court of law in a just manner, but
you're not, and that's
that doesn't always happen.
Yeah, I don't think, not only does it not always happen, I think it's very rare that it happened, and that's not just from only my experience, which was ridiculous, but from other people I know as well. There is no justice system. There is the system of, we do whatever we want. If you don't like it, you know, oh well. And the government, you know, pretty much is going to do what they want. And that's where, you know, again, whether it's something like what they're doing with Monsanto, and that's very detrimental, you know, assuming that these things are bad for you, and I can't say that they're good. I mean, I think it's only a matter of, and I think you'd probably agree with this, I don't think there's really a debate of if it's good or bad. I just think it's a matter of how bad is it. Like, is it bad enough that, you know, you're going to get cancer from it, or is it just, you know, maybe when you get a little older, you know, you'll get sick or something. I don't know. But I don't think that it's something like that can be good for you, you know.
Well, it's hard to tell, because we don't, like I said earlier, we don't have the science down where we You know, we don't really understand how chromosomes and DNA create these protein or how they code for them. And the science of it now, where we, you know, just randomly inject certain portions of DNA into a structure, it's very sloppy. And, you know, it's not something we can control down at an atomic level. So it's really, you know, in some cases it might be okay. In some cases it might be more dangerous. Like, there's different strains of genetically modified organisms that are more toxic than others. And, you know, there's actually something else I wanted to bring up. There was a case back from, I think it started in 2006, where the Department of Health actually funded this huge study through Case Law School, where they were trying to create guidelines for creating policies in human enhancement or directed evolution, which is, this is more advanced than, you know, like genetically modified food products. This is like taking human DNA and engineering it and putting it into different animals. And, you know, after this 3 or 4 year study, they didn't have any public statement issued. So, you know, even through government's best efforts, it's very difficult for them to even come up with laws to regulate this sort of technology, because we don't understand how it functions. We don't even have a good enough understanding of our own morals and values to, you know, understand how we treat living organisms, or if we were to be responsible for creating something that was, you know, a mutant, you know, how would we treat it? Would we treat it as human or as animal? You know, like, what would the legislation be that applies to that?
You'd call Professor X.
Really confused in the legal realm.
You'd call Professor X and the rest of the X-Men there. The mutants.
Yeah, we have all sorts of movies about mutant humans.
Yeah, and that was the same thing in there, where that's exactly what had happened, that they looked into, okay, we need laws to stop this and whatever. And, you know, I almost feel like it's like people that are making these movies are, you know all this shit that we're not aware of, because there's so much stuff that, you know, is either very similar or ends up happening in the future, you know. And it's just, and maybe it's just common sense or easy to figure out, or history repeating itself, really, or patterns of people.
It could be that. It could be, you know, people are so creative that they see trends in society, like different advancements, and they just postulate about the future of it. That's how a lot of, you know, artistic masterpieces are created in literature and in movies. But also, I think it's just maybe somebody who's particularly creative that hears about these studies or these cases and is so inspired that they, you know, they create what they imagine is going to happen in the future. And that's something like, if you ever read George Orwell or, you know, A Brave New World, you know, this kind of stuff has been talked about for a long time, you know, for longer than I've been alive, for longer than most of people have been alive, you know, and some of it comes true, some of it doesn't, but a lot of this is just, you know,
it seems people, like, more than not does, and the stuff that we might think isn't coming true is a matter of time before it is, or it's going on and we just don't know about it.
Yeah, and there are a few people who know about it, and I'm sure if, you know, you knew where to look, if you had some sort of direction that you were looking into, you could learn these things. But, you know, most people are ignorant of it just because it's not something that's relevant to their everyday life. Whereas, you know, if you just see it by chance when you're studying something, you know, that can have a huge impact on you, because you see, you know, it's really important and you want people to know about it, but, you know, unfortunately nobody's really interested at the time, so you have to find a way to make it interesting. And I think that's where, you know, these movies come from, is people trying to draw attention to things that they see happening, that they, you know, they want to present it in a way that, you know, people will be fascinated by it, or they'll be, oh, it's a cool story. And then, you know, they'll be more accustomed to thinking about it in the future.
Like you look at the one of the recent movies, I don't know if you've seen the Captain America Winter Soldier, where essentially it was a machine that they created that's going to go and murder everybody who they think is going to be a threat in the future. And it was something like 20 million people. I'm surprised they even got that movie made, to be honest. And maybe it's just because, you know, it's more aimed at comic book fans and maybe they wouldn't think of it that way. But it's pretty much like Obama's kill list or something.
Yeah, that's what it seems like. You know, if you're somebody who, you know, is, you know, more skeptical of the government and you watch that movie, that's what you're going to take out of it, is that, you know, this is something that the government's already planning on doing. Like, they have a list of everybody who's in the media and who says negative things about them, and they track your Facebook friends and their friends, and they draw this, you know, net of relations between people who might potentially be terrorist threats. You know, and if that's something that's already on your mind, that's what you're going to get out of the movie. Whereas if you're just watching it for entertainment purposes, you're like, oh, wow, look at that super evil power. You know, like, hopefully that never happens.
Yeah, and I guess that's something I can probably think about movies when I was a kid that I look at now and see, you know, the relation to government and things like that, whereas at the time I probably didn't even think of it that way. So one of the things, as I kind of mentioned earlier, but that I had talked about last night, I had Ken Shorgen on of the Daily Economist. You can check him out at the Daily Economist. And he's, you know, talking a lot about the potential currency collapse and things like that, which is a whole nother issue. And just the, again, so many things that are going on and where to focus and whatever. I mean, what do you think, if you had to pick, I guess, one thing, what do you think is the most important thing to focus on? And what for you stresses you out the most, if, you know, at all? Or what do you worry about the most when it comes to, you know, things related to government and the things going on?
Oh, that's hard. I would have to narrow it down to two things. First of all, I drive a lot. I have, you know, a 35-minute commute to work each day that I go, just one way. So in total, it's at least an hour that I'm driving every day that I work. And, you know, even when I'm not working, sometimes I drive more than that, you know. So I drive a lot, and I see a lot of police officers driving around, and I've heard of some really outrageous tickets that people have gotten, and I don't want to be one of those people. But, you know, either way you choose, whether you, you know, buy the sticker and the inspection and get your car registered, you know, you're still paying money that way. But if you don't, then you get pulled over and ticketed and possibly towed. You could be ticketed for speeding or having lights out, you know, all sorts of things, tailgating too close. So that's something I worry about on a daily basis when I'm driving, is am I going to be pulled over and ticketed? You know, another thing is when I get my paycheck every pay period and I look at how much I would have had if it wasn't for taxes, and then how much was taken out for taxes, that really angers me. That's money that I never get to see. So it's those two things mainly, just that money is or may be taken from me against my will, you know, for things that I haven't done wrong. You know, even if I am speeding, you know, I always drive at what I think is a reasonable speed. I've never hit anybody. I've never caused an accident. You know, I feel like that's not something that's creating a victim, unless I do hit somebody. But, you know, that hasn't happened yet. Hopefully it never will. But if it does, I'd be willing to, you know, reimburse them for whatever it is. But, you know, things like that where my money's being taken away from me without my will, that first and foremost is what makes me angry and sad and, you know, afraid for certain things. But also, It's the fact that it's going to things that I don't support, and there's no way that I could know where all of that money's going. Like, sure, it breaks it down on your paycheck and says this much is going to Social Security,
right.
And you know, this is going to other things like welfare, you know. But that's just a very small portion of it.
Well, like, they take it and use it for other shit anyway. It's not like they put it in that fund and actually pay it to that. It's like they borrow from it anyway. So.
Yeah, I know. And that's, you know, you'll never know where your money is going when it's taken from you. So, you know, that's another thing that worries me. But if that weren't the case, if I didn't have to worry about getting tickets and my money being taken away through taxes, you know, there wouldn't be a government. Like, how would they get money without those two sources of income? You know, so if I didn't have to worry about those anymore, that would be really good news for everyone, you know, because nobody would have to worry about that. You know, we would all be able to keep our money and not support things that we didn't want to support. And, you know, if I wanted to support a family that didn't have an income, if I wanted to be charitable, I would probably be much more effective at it if that money wasn't being forcibly taken from me and given to a bunch of different families.
Yeah, that's what I think people don't realize neither. They think, well, if there wasn't welfare and taxes and, you know, all these people would just starve and whatever, and don't think about the fact that, you know, well, people would have more money and they would do that on their own. And especially if you live in a neighborhood, there's just so much shit that's why I keep going back to, you know, the conditioning and the calculation of the government and propaganda and stuff like that. Because I really think that if you live in a neighborhood, you know, and you want to have a nice neighborhood, if you have kids, you want them to have a nice place to be and play and stuff like that. And you don't want people out there homeless. You'd want to help them. You know, just as an example, or, you know, if you knew your neighbors and, you know, some of the neighbors come on hard times, you know, the rest of the neighborhood gets together and say, hey, we're going to help them out, you know, and it's automatically, oh, well, if there's no welfare, then these people just, you know, die and starve. Like if there's no government police, then, you know, everybody gets murdered.
Yeah, and, you know, the other aspect of this that applies to, like, our food supply and GMOs is if these large companies weren't being supported by the government, you know, think about all the variety that you would see in grocery stores. There'd be so many different brands, and there'd be, you know, so many different varieties of, you know, specific things. There would be so many more options. And, you know, I think that's something that everybody wants, or, you know, at least that's what I want. And that's why I spend my money wisely when I do spend it. You know, but I think that would be a benefit for everybody. And, you know, maybe some people don't realize that, but, you know, that's something that I would really look forward to. And I would want to try everything out. You know, I would support a lot of businesses if they provided good product. You know, and that's the way it should be, you know, not that, you know, you should be made to give your money to this specific company, corporation, organization, whatever it is, you know, even the government, you shouldn't have to give your money to them. You should be able to choose where you're giving it. You know, that's really the foundation of the free market and, you know, any form of success.
So is there anything that you worry about? Like, you know, do you ever worry about just your rights being violated or things getting to a point where, you know, if the police just want to come in your house, they will, which I technically think it's pretty much, you know, that's where it is now. It's just they don't have the resources. But do you think about things like that or maybe not even potentially right now, but in the future, or having a family in the future and worrying about, well, if I don't do what the government says when it comes to my kids, they might just take them away. And that's not something, you know, again, that's just a conspiracy. I mean, that's something that's going on. I don't know if you heard another story, and there's one every week, where I think it was like two 7-year-olds kissed, not be tongue or anything, just kissed, and they got the police involved. Now, they ended up not filing any charges, but this is the type of world that we're living in, and it's crazy and crazier every day. And I guess this is coming from more, because these are some of the things that I think about. And I know I've had some different experiences where, you know, I have been, fucked up by the police. I have been arrested for nothing with the police telling me straight up that they're just arresting me because they don't like my demeanor. You know, so I've had things like that, unfortunately, happen. But do you ever think about things like that, or, you know, possibly what can happen in the future with all the technology and really what I look at what they're doing now, I look at it as almost the infrastructure of, okay, we're setting up the spy grid, we're giving the police all these weapons, we're setting up a military within the U.S., you know, and that at some point they're going to be ready to go full force with that. Like, what are your thoughts, I guess, on that?
Well, that thought is very terrifying. And I just like to think that I avoid doing things that make me look like a target. And I know that's kind of ironic, me saying that now, being on, you know, Nonpartisan Liberty for All or Free Talk Live or like any of those other public shows that are, verbally anti-government. But
Yeah, that probably doesn't help. Well, my show no one hears it anyway, but, you know, Free Talk Live, when you were on there, a lot of people heard that, so.
Yeah, but I try to stay below the radar. I just, if I do things that are illegal, I don't make them super public. And if I do, then it's in a situation where, they can't really charge me for anything, you know, so I try to not do things that would make them want to come after me. I mean, it is something I think about. I think it's a possibility in the future where, you know, they notice you acting strangely and they'll come investigate you and, you know, take you away quietly in the night kind of scenario. I just hope that doesn't happen. And if it starts happening, I would hope that I'm wise enough to, you know, get out of the area. And I know that sounds sad, but, you know, once the system has become so overt and power crazy, there's not anything that me as a single person can do, especially not if I'm behind bars or dead. So I would like to think that I just get out of the scenario and try to help as much as I can, because I have to be concerned for my safety as well as everyone else's. But if it came to a scenario where I like growing plants in my house. I have a lot of them. But if I was growing something that was, like, say I was growing a pot plant here, which I'm not, but if I ever decided I wanted to, and somehow the government found out, my house could be raided and I could be sent to jail for a long time. And even innocent bystanders could also possibly be drawn into the mix, and that's not something that I want to put people through. I don't want to put myself through. So I do wonder about things like that, but like I said, it's just for me, I try to be wise with where I take my risks. And I know a lot of people who are not as secretive. They're more vocal, and they say the idea behind it is I'm doing what I think is right and I'm not hurting anybody. So if they have a problem, they can come after me. But I'm not going to alter my principles at all. And, that's great and everything, trying to be a white knight, but it's not functional in a world where you can be sentenced for something like that.
It
and
might
then
not
you will never get your word out.
Yeah, the smartest thing to do. I mean, I understand what you're saying as well. But it's like, hey, I'm smoking weed all the time or something, and I'm just going to broadcast it to everybody. So, hey, I'm at my house smoking weed, so the cops can come and arrest me or something. I understand wanting to stand up and live free. But at the same time, you got to be kind of smart about it too.
Right. I mean, I understand, you know, being principled and not compromising. But to me, it seems like it would be very difficult to function every day if you didn't compromise on anything. You know, so it's, to me, it's a matter of, I can do things that I enjoy that, you know, express my freedom, but also not publicize them in a way that's going to, you know, get me in trouble later on down the road.
Right. Yeah. And I obviously, you know, I'm going to come out and stand up and talk about the things and ideas that I want to get out there. But, you know, I'm not going to do it totally unfiltered, where, not that I'm doing anything, you know, illegal anyway, but you never know what is going to become illegal. And that's the other thing, too. You know, right now, you might be doing things that, of course, are mostly legal. But then, you know, something like we're doing now, just doing an internet radio show and saying some of the things we're saying, maybe 5 years from now, that's going to be against the law. Maybe it's considered hate speech. Maybe it's considered terrorism. And yeah, these are the things that I think about, unfortunately, because sometimes it does get, I think, stressful at times, when, especially when, you know, I'm doing a show 3 times a week, so I have to be thinking about this stuff, because I got to think about, okay, well, what am I going to talk about tonight? So, but I mean, right, it's the reality, and it's stressful, and it's like, Jesus, could I live, you know, I think about, could I live in a society like that, where the laws are to that extent? And I don't think that I could, you know, whether I go and live in the, you know, sewer system or something or whatever. I don't know. Because I was in some movie, I think, what was it? The one with Sylvester Stallone was frozen and he came back or something. Demolition Man, I think. But there were people living in the sewer to get away from you know, the tyrannical LA was what it was, but.
Yeah, and that's really too bad. That's an unfortunate scenario, but I just thought of a really good example where this is something, like, there comes a certain point where you can't compromise, and, like, you have no choice but to say, like, no, I'm not going to take any of this. You know, and, you know, the recent Health Care Act is something that comes to mind when you brought that up, because you know, it's now required that you have health insurance. It's a law. If you don't have it, then you'll get fined at the end of the year. And, you know, for a lot of people, including me, paying the fine is much cheaper than actually buying health insurance. That's one thing.
It's not going to be for long, though. That's what the fucked up thing is going to be. But sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. Go ahead, and then I'll finish.
Anyway, I was just saying that's something where you just have to say, like, no, I'm not going to do what you ask me, because right, you've gone too far this time. You know, like, there is a certain line that you cross where you don't bend to the rules anymore.
But what they're doing with that, because if you look at the escalations of, okay, well, this year it's this much and this year it's this much. I mean, it's going to progressively increase. And I think, you know, just like I was saying about other stuff, I don't even think it's all about the money. I think part of it's about the money. And I think everything's always partially about the money, but I think it's a lot about control and having control over all your records and all the different details about your life. And it's just more and more control. And it's crazy. And I even feel like, you know, just, hey, I fuck insurance. I'll just, you know, pay cash. I mean, they have something now called concierge medicine, where you pay, you know, like $400 a month and you get unlimited visits to your doctor. You know, of course, if you got a, you know, emergency surgery or something like that, it doesn't cover it. But then you could just get one of those, you know, emergency plans, you know, that just covers that stuff. But you know, and last night, one of the other things we talked about was moving towards a cashless society as well. So you have all of these things that it just is moving more and more towards more government control. And really, and I, you know, I say this all the time on the show, that really what I think is that it's wanting to control every aspect of your life. And that's really where I see it going. And I think there's a lot of things that you can look at, you know, even though it's incremental. I mean, you can look at it over, you know, 50 years or even 100 years, but you can see these incremental changes in how it's more and more control over your everyday life. And it's how much are people going to take until they're like, hey, we're not going to take this anymore because we don't want to live that way.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. And I just want to end on this, you know, this thought. Think about how much more crazy this is all going to get once, you know, people start genetically modifying themselves and people live to be like 150, 200, 300 years old. And, you know, people are modifying their brains to be more active. You know, what role is government going to play in this future world where, you know, people are surviving longer and have more capabilities and more access and potentially more capacity to control other people?
Yeah, I mean, with a lot of that stuff, too, if they're able to more mind control and implant chips in people's heads and... It's just, yeah, it's just, I guess, gets scary and scarier. But hopefully, on a positive note, you know, people can continue to speak out and, you know, independent media can continue to speak out and more people can see things for what they are. And obviously, there's a lot more people outside the government than in the government. And, you know, just really, I guess, changing hearts and minds and people really believing in freedom. And that's the way I think peacefully things can change, is just people not complying and saying, I think that's the biggest thing to me, is not complying and people saying, look, you know, we want to live free and we're not going to do this. And what are you going to do? You're going to arrest us all, you know, and
right.
At some point you can't. So, sorry, go ahead.
I just like to believe in, you know, the spirit of humanity where people will stand up for what's best for themselves and their families at some point. So, you know, hopefully in the future when people are evolving and, you know, they're putting in effort to try and improve their existence, not only as individuals, but as an entire species. So, you know, I can only hope, and, you know, I really do place some amount of faith in people to be able to accomplish that. Or at least strive for that, you know, for better lives for themselves and everyone. Hopefully, you know, someday we'll get to a point where we don't need these antiquated techniques of government anymore.
Well, I don't think we need them now. It's just, how do we get rid of them, I guess? And that's really, I think, the biggest question is, I think a lot of people have a lot of ideas of how things should be, and I think a lot of people agree on that. It's just, how the hell do we get there? And I guess we'll have to wait and
see. Be the change you want to see, like Gandhi said.
Well, yeah, I mean, and I... You know, for me, I think the best thing for me right now is I just, you know, do what I can, speak out and do my show. And hopefully I reach one or two people and you know, it makes a difference. And hopefully, you know, it makes them think, and then they look into more things on their own and they see things for what they are. And yeah, so... And of course, every appearance that you come on the show, you of course help with that as well. And I appreciate that as always. So thanks again for coming on the show. I know we kind of got away from the GMO thing, but it was kind of related to some of the other stuff. So.
Yeah, well, I appreciate the opportunity to come on, and I always enjoy, you know, spreading these thoughts. So this is a really good domain for it. So thank you for providing that.
All right. Well, thank you, Miss infamous, I guess. And hopefully we will see you again soon.
Most definitely.
All right. Well, thanks, everybody. We will be back tomorrow for End the Government Police Thursday with co-host Thomas Woody. And we'll be talking all about what is going on in the police state, along with a bunch of stuff that I really didn't get to talk about regarding Baltimore in the past couple of weeks. So we'll talk a little about that as well. Thanks, everybody.
Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous thing.